All right, it says we're live.
Ooh. All right, hello.
Someone go on YouTube and check this out.
You don't trust it?
No, I don't trust it, man. The technical difficulties going on tonight. Oh, someone's got to check this out and see if we're live, because usually it gives me a little live control thing here. So, but it's not doing that. We're gonna, oh, you know, we'll view in the watch page. How's that?
Hey, JoJo, if you're logged on, message me. Oh, there we go.
Oh.
We're a little delayed. Yeah. We're on.
All right, turn it off.
Okay. There's an echo.
It's beautiful. Are we on? Someone go on YouTube and check this out. Yep, that's us. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn my juice down here. The technical difficulties going on. Oh, my God. All right, we made it. No Facebook Live tonight, but, you know, we're going to do next best thing on the YouTube. So we got the fire women up here. Woohoo! Cheryl, Marty, and Jennifer. Is that that's right?
Because yes.
I saw on your Facebook profiles you had these different kind of hyphen names and stuff. So I was kind of I didn't know. I'm like, man, what am I gonna call them? Because usually I first of all, I suck with names. I'm the worst with names and stuff. And it's like hey bub, hey chief, what's going on, dude? You know, everybody's dude or bub. You know what I mean? Because I'm like, I can't remember anybody's name. So, oh my God. Okay, now I have to just kind of relax a little bit here. Okay, I've been going like, I'm gonna use a phrase, balls to the wall, trying to get this thing running, and thank God we got it running and stuff. Though, we good?
Yeah.
Is it going?
Somebody is watching.
Somebody's watching.
Hello.
It's probably you. You're watching.
Somebody's watching.
Oh my God. Hey, so let's get right to the meat of the matter. You guys got some gigs coming, right?
Yes.
I'll call you girls. How about, can I call you girls? Is that better? Ladies?
No, ladies.
You like ladies?
I like ladies.
Okay, we'll call you ladies then.
Hey, ladies.
Well, the ladies have some gigs coming up. We're going to get to the gigs right now.
Yeah.
Because what I like to do usually in the beginning, because there's people that kind of tune in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Some tune in the middle. Some go towards the end. Mm-hmm. So kind of like to sprinkle them around. That way everybody can get a little gist of where you guys are going to be playing. So. Who wants to do the honors?
Well, this Saturday night, thanks to Jim at Texas Mist.
Yay, Jim.
Yes. And by the way, Jim and I go way back. We worked together 7 years ago. He was my doorman at Egos.
I think you were telling me about that.
Yeah. So we've known each other a long time. So he'd also been pestering me about this, saying, when are you going to get this off the ground, you know, for about the last year or so. So
yeah.
When I reached out to him, I said, yeah, we finally got it. And he's like, of course I'm going to book you. So
that's awesome.
We are playing Saturday night, 25th. We are in the 11 o'clock spot. We actually have some of our friends go by. Most of the time they go by Sue's and the Boozers, but
Sue and the Boozers.
Sue's and the Boozers.
Oh, Sue's and the Boozers.
Yeah, yeah.
Messing up their name already.
And they're going as Small Town Girls. They're a Journey tribute.
Oh, that's right. Mm-hmm. I had Jim call in the other night. Or actually, we called Jim, and he said that they were playing.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. That sounds pretty cool.
Yeah. And then War Pigs with Kember. Singing, gonna finish out.
I think Randy's playing drums with him, right? From Rock Hard.
From Rock Hard, I think so.
Yeah, because he played a gig with him over at Hanover's, I think. So.
Yeah.
You know what's really funny? I got a thing today. You know Wes, right?
Yes.
Anyways, Wes plays in this band called, what is it, Def Legend?
Mm-hmm.
So I get this thing from Ticketmaster today on my phone. Like, you know, like they have all the big shows. And all of a sudden, it says, you know, get your, pre-sale for Def Legend down at the Aztec Theater. I'm like, what? I said, hey, does Def Leppard know about this?
Wes, you've gone.
Yeah, so it was like a pre-sale for his Def Leppard tribute band. I'm like, what?
Look out, Def Leppard.
Believe that, man?
Competition.
That's craziness, man.
That's awesome.
I know, but I'm like, ugh. You know, and I always wondered about that. We were talking about that at work the other day about, like about all these bands, like there's a Brit Floyd. You ever seen Brit Floyd from like the Pink Floyd tribute? They're from England.
No.
Oh, they're really good. Anyways, they do like a full laser light thing and everything, and it's like it's badass. I saw them over at Cedar Park Center.
Nice.
But it's a full on Pink Floyd show. Two hour and a half sets.
Wow.
They do the whole light show, and they sound just like Pink Floyd. And I'm like wondering, I mean, do they have to like kind of like give some money to Pink Floyd over that? I mean, mm-hmm. there's got to be something going on, you know? Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering about, I got to talk to Wes about the, you know, the Def Legend thing. I'm like, man, I don't know. I don't think Def Leppard's really hurting for money right now, but, you know, I'm sure they like a little piece of that action.
Fly under the radar. No one will know.
Yeah. Exactly.
So exactly. The cult will be coming after you guys, so.
Yeah. Okay, let's move on.
John Tempesta, you out there listening?
Come to our show.
Yeah, come to our show. Is he still playing with him? You know who that is, right?
Yeah. I don't know.
He was with White Zombie forever, and then he got that gig with them. So
yeah,
he's a real good drummer.
I mean, that's kind of been a rotating show for the last, you know, 15, 20 years.
Really?
Since the late 80s, early 90s, it's been a rotating show.
If you look at their drummer lineup, like the drummers, it's like...
Well, Matt Sorum went right to Guns N' Roses. Yeah, he was like, see ya, gotta go.
Axel's calling.
Yeah, I mean, who can blame him for that one, you know? So, well, that's how he got the gig, because they were, the Cult was opening up for Guns N' Roses, mm-hmm. and that's how they saw him, so.
They
sucked him up, yeah. You know, poor Steve couldn't play anymore, so they had to, couldn't play anymore, he's all heroined out, so they had to get another drummer, so. Mm-hmm. Go on with your dates, I'm sorry, I digress.
No,
I get talking and I can't shut up, so.
That's all right. And then Sunday afternoon we were playing Independence Brewery for an AIDS Ride benefit.
Country Ride for AIDS, yeah.
Hill Country Ride for AIDS, and that is at between 3 and 4.
Yep.
Cool.
So, yeah. Beer, tacos.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, tacos. Got to go to that.
For a good cause.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Tacos for a good cause. That's what you just call it to get everybody to go. Tacos for a good cause.
Yeah.
Anybody else playing on that or just you guys?
Just us and then
a
local singer-songwriter named Nicole Wagner. Mm-hmm. So she'll be our opening act.
I'm trying to think if I've ever heard her before. I've heard there's so many Wagners around, you know? Like Robert Wagner from Suede's a good friend of mine, so. Oh, you got anything else? You gonna pimp some more dates?
So far, that's it.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
I saw a calendar. It looked pretty long. No, not yours?
Yeah.
Oh, it must be somebody else's. It's yours, I think. Is it your calendar? Yeah,
probably.
She did have a long calendar. I saw it on there.
I play around.
You got more than one band?
Yeah.
Really? You're one of those, huh? Yeah. Nice.
Yeah. So we're waiting for something else to hit.
Okay.
Hopefully.
Yeah, I'm actually good. I haven't been to the Texas Fest yet.
Oh, what? You're going to love it.
Yeah.
I was going to say, at least you're going, if you're not going out there this weekend, you're at least going out there because you're doing a live podcast, right?
No.
What's the deal,
there you go. I'll tell you, man, the live podcast, man, it's like I was tearing my hair out up at the Oasis like about a week ago. I was like, oh my God, this is too much.
You guys were working off a cell phone.
Yeah,
there.
We had to in the end, yeah.
The
get up on this little harder.
Oh, were you like paddling out in the middle of the lake with a big old antenna?
We'll make this story very short. But what happened was my buddy Bill, he was saying to me, he goes, I got this hot spot from work. I'm going to bring it up there. It's going to be great. No problem. He gets it up there and it's like pulling like, you know, 2 megabytes a second or whatever. It's just like nothing. I'm like going, oh my. And we're like 15 minutes away from going live with this thing at 6:30. Mm. And, we tried 4 or 5 cell phones. So finally I said, man, I don't want to use my cell phone for this because Crystal's going to kick my ass. Because I mean, the data plan on that stuff, when you're streaming high def video and audio and stuff, it gets crazy. Mm-hmm. So I tried it and it rang out a little better. We just went with it and it actually worked out pretty well. So it wasn't bad. And we got through it. I mean, we just didn't know what we had nothing planned. I'm not one of these kind of guys that plans like questions and all sorts of stuff. We just go. And just go with it. Just have a good time with it. And that's what we did. So.
Well, the photos on Facebook look great. There were some photos.
Oh, was there?
Yeah. I think there was one of your buddy running sound over there for you.
Yeah. It's a whole bunch of us. Yeah. And then Tony, you know Tony Park? He's playing a band called Push Monkey back in the day.
Oh, my God. I remember them.
Yeah. Well, he plays in a band called 333. And he was up there.
Cool.
So if you see that the guy in the black suit in the middle, that's Tony.
But I saw them at Auditorium Shores. What did they do? The KLBJ Shore thing back in the day. And I saw them. Yeah.
Yeah. He plays in a band called 333 Don. They're, nice. They kick some major ass. So if you ever get a chance to go see them, they're really, really good. All original band.
Nice.
So he sat in with us. Like we just did three of us just podcasted for, you know, the guys from the band come over and, you know, talk and stuff. I don't know if you saw all of it, but Yeah, it didn't turn out that bad. But I mean, yeah, next time we go to do it, I mean, we're gonna have to like pull some professional stuff out there, because I mean, especially at the Oasis, it's a beautiful place to go, but there's, I mean, there's no signal out there.
Yeah.
People even have cell phones are worried about signals. So
yeah, it's like, I can't text this picture of my family.
But by the grace of God and baby Jesus and everybody else, we got through it. I'm telling you. So, hey, so how did you ladies get this band together? I got to hear about this, because I saw some videos, man, on YouTube and stuff. It actually looks really cool, man.
Well, thanks.
You know?
Well, we all met in music school. So we've been all part of, at one point or another, an organization here in Austin called Girl Guitar. And hopefully at this point, there's some of the ladies from the school watching. So it is. It started out as a music school run by local musicians to help women, you know, express themselves, learn how to play and sing, basically. And it started out as acoustic classes, and then after that became other instruments, and then band classes, where women would get together who have some, you know, some knowledge of their instrument, and basically put together a small set and then play a show. Forever it was at Antone's, and now it kind of bounces back and forth between Antone's and next one's at Speakeasy, and then One-to-One. And so I joined after a breakup about 5 years ago when I,
one of those, huh? Okay. I need a hobby now.
Well, it wasn't that. I needed somebody to accompany me.
Oh.
You know, because I'd go and do open mics with him. And, you know, I was like, well, I probably need to figure out how to accompany myself. So I joined to learn to play and sing. And that kind of morphed into joining one of the band classes as a vocalist. And that led into the first band that I had, which was an all-female yacht rock cover band.
A what? A what? We gotta, whoa, back up, reverse. What is that?
Yacht rock is a soft rock from the late 70s and early 80s.
Oh boy.
kind of guilty pleasures.
So. I'll tell you what, I got a quick story. I got this guy I work with. He's like one of these kind of dudes that he likes going like digging in the bin, like the $2 CD bin at Walmart.
Yeah.
And he's got some crazy stuff, and he plays like the Carpenters' greatest hits every day. Every day. I'm ready to choke myself. I'm like, man, you know, I get it. I get it. You like that, but it's too much. Then he's got another one. Here's the best one. I don't know where he got it. The song, it's it's the disco version of the soundtrack to Star Wars.
Oh my god, I had that.
You know what I'm talking about?
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
so I had that 8-track as a kid. I used to skate around.
But what is? I mean, what is that?
Yeah.
What?
There's a whole album.
Oh, wonderful! Yeah,
awesome.
Yeah.
We used to skate in the basement.
Oh my lord!
Roller skate around.
So, anyways, this guy plays this crazy stuff, and it's like, and he plays. He's got like a whole drawer full of like CDs, and he plays the same three or four of them every day. And it's like, man, enough! All right, I'll just. And every once in a while, he'll come up with a new CD. Like you know, he got it for like $2 somewhere. You know, you know, some like old Bon Jovi CD or something. You know.
Slippery when wet.
I think that's one that he bought, actually. Which is a great record. I mean, you know, I actually bought that the day it came out, but that was like 30, oh my god, it's 31 years ago.
Yeah.
It wasn't yesterday.
No, it wasn't yesterday.
Yeah.
31 years that came out.
Yeah.
No way.
Yeah. Yeah.
Have you seen the Nirvana baby? The baby from the cover of the Nirvana, Nevermind?
Yeah.
Yeah, wow, it made me feel old. I was like, what?
Man, unreal.
What happened? Where'd the 90s go?
So I'm sorry to interrupt.
Keep going. It's okay.
Get used to it, because it's going to happen a lot.
That's right. So, the first band that we had, we did covers of, you know, Hall & Oates and Exile and Jackson Brown. It was awesome.
So it was just like an acoustic duo kind of thing?
No. It was a 6-piece cover band. Yeah.
Man, you went.
And
you went deep on that one, huh?
Yeah, it was.
Wow.
We called it Reuniti on Ice.
Reuniti on Ice.
See, this is how I know you're.
I'll tell you, that's one thing about. I'm from the north, but I'll tell you, the best band names are down here. People come with the craziest shit down here.
So yeah, after that kind of folded, I just went back into classes, and you know, through we do these, you know, like every 2 months. So I've gotten to basically, you know, portray all of my idols. We've covered Motley Crue.
Oh, there you go.
We've covered Jane's Addiction. We covered Concrete Blonde last fall, and
we did Toto.
Oh my god! And I play keys in some of these. So like, oh my god, playing Hold the Line, I was ready to shoot myself.
We survived.
Oh yeah, like we must have eaten so many Twizzlers in stress eating.
Yes, Twizzlers, wine, and beer.
Yes.
Oh my god.
trying to play Rosanna, trying to do that pretty shuffle.
Those are tough, man.
Oh my god. Oh yeah.
That, Rosanna's a tough tune.
And then trying to play and sing it.
I was done. I was like, okay.
Yeah,
check that off the bucket list. Mm-hmm. Put it back in the folder.
Did you play it right though?
It was an approximation on everyone's part.
Let's just say we had some creative freedom on it. Okay.
Yeah, there's some video. Well, if you
do you like Led Zeppelin at all?
Heck yeah.
Okay, Into the Outdoor, there's a song called Fool in the Rain.
Yes.
It's the same kind of shuffle. Yep. Mm-hmm. And a good friend of mine, his name's Kenny Sheritz. He's a great guy, and he's a great drummer. He's a professional drum tech. He's tech for Janet Jackson and Stevie Wonder, but he knows his shit. He really does. And I was talking, we had a drummer's podcast up here a long time ago, and I was asking him, I said, man, I just, that tune, of course, we're drinking a little bit, you know. That's the one night I came off the wagon for that one, you know. Oh, God. Anyways, and I asked him, I said, man, I said, to this day, I can't, you know, I've been playing drums since I was 5 years old. I'm almost 50, you know. I don't play professionally anymore, but it's one tune I could never nail. Is that you?
Hey. Yeah, I'm hearing voices.
I was just updating to see who was watching us.
Don't worry about it. They'll watch. They'll be there. No, so anyways, I asked him, I said, about Fool in the Rain, because he used to play in a Led Zeppelin cover band like 20 years ago. And he goes, that song is not easy. It's, you know, but he told me the origins from it and where it kind of came from. This thing, this guy named Bernard Purdy.
Yep.
Yeah, the Purdy Shuffle. That's where it came from.
Yeah.
And, but it's, and everybody in the room was like, yeah, that's a bitch to play. Mm-hmm. And the Rosanna thing is like right off of that.
It's, oh, definitely.
It's the same thing.
Oh,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's a tough tune.
All those ghost notes.
Yeah, it's tough. Yeah. I just kind of gave up.
I was going to say, you listen to Thriller, you're listening to Toto.
Yeah.
Is all the Toto guys on that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They backed him up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. It's crazy. Like we had found some isolated tracks.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. It was nuts as far as the vocals and the harmonies in it. And then, you know, different instrumentation all isolated. And it was just like, what are we doing?
And I'll tell you what, if you go to YouTube and you check out you Google like Rosanna isolated tracks, it's pretty awesome, you know, because you can just hear like the background vocals and everything, and it's pretty cool.
Yeah, they do the same thing with a lot of bands. Of course, a lot of the John Bonham stuff, you go in there and just isolated tracks. Like, jeez,
man. It blow your mind.
Totally. Mm-hmm. What blows my mind is his son is better than he is.
Yeah.
His son is ridiculously great.
He's so good. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was watching it. We always talk about it up here. It's like, you know, you've ever seen that Celebration Day? They did the OT. It was like, I think it's like 10 years old now, where Zeppelin actually got back together.
Okay.
For some benefit concert or something at the O2 Arena in England. And Jason Bonham played drums on it. He just murdered it. It's like, oh, my God, you actually watch that. He is the way he plays, he is so clean and so precise. I mean, it's like he's like, you know, here's his dad was like awesome, but he's you know, it's ridiculous how good he is. You got to watch that video. You'd be blown away.
I've seen a little bit. It wasn't that one, but I saw some live performance with him.
Oh, he's great.
And I was just like, Lord.
Yeah. I think the problem is a lot of people can't get along with him. That's why he doesn't really last in bands all that long. Yeah.
You got to be a good hang if you want to get into some bands.
Yeah, well, I mean, he's got the name and the you know, the way he plays is that's all he needs.
Yeah.
So he can be a jerk, so. So what's your story? He's over in the corner he's like, "I'm going to hide. Yeah. I don't want to say nothing. I'm over here now."
So Did I, Marty, meet you about that time, or it was probably right before, right? It was about 2 years ago?
Yeah, about 2 years ago.
Yeah.
And we did Concrete Blonde together, and we've done, like, some 80s covers.
Yeah, Usually our musical director is Heather Webb. He used to be in Bug Girl, and she had an Ozzy tribute, Princess of Darkness, for a couple of years. And she was also in Adrian the Sickness. Amazing bass player and an amazing teacher. So, and I know she's probably out there. Well, she will be watching soon because their class is almost over.
they can watch tomorrow.
Yeah.
It's all right.
But she was heading out of town to go to Mexico, and her ex-girlfriend, Amber Saxon from Hell's Bells, was here.
Okay.
Yeah, who is also a good friend of the school. And so she took over the class, and I said, can we do the cult? And she's like, fuck yeah! You know? So that's, yeah. And it was like, oh my God, this actually works. So I spent the next year and a half, almost 2 years, trying to get people back together to do this. And finally we did, like, that's last cool. fall. Yeah.
So how did you roll in?
So I was at
the same way? You weren't at the guitar school, though.
Yeah, well, actually, I used to gig back in the early 2000s, and I've been kind of just playing around town, and I was at a jam. Can I give a shout-out to somebody?
Shout-out okay. whoever you want to.
I
want to
give a shout-out to our buddies over at the Anderson Mill Pub right now. They're doing the jam right now.
Oh, Chris Max?
David Sensat, Corky Grote, Henry Crafts. You know,
I'm thinking of Palmer Lane Tavern. I'm sorry.
And Mike Ryan. And so I was out there, and a friend of ours, Finia, who's probably listening, and I were out there, and she invited Jennifer, and we got on stage and just looked at each other at the jam. Hey, what do you know? What do you know? We played some songs, and we had a lot of fun together. And then they recruited me to do, I think it was the Toto.
But I think yeah, we were like, you want to play with some other women?
Yeah, well, because I'm
you ended up doing some Whitesnake, right?
Man, like I did
Whitesnake, and then I did a Red Hot Chili Peppers cover band, which was awesome.
Oh yeah.
But what was intriguing to me and how I got drawn to that program, I was playing in bands and gigging, but I'm used to being the only girl, and you know, you're the drummer and all that. So I was like, oh, this would be interesting, like not being the only girl. Yeah, so I joined
women.
Along. Yeah, it's our little,
it's all women.
You're like a
our
gang.
Tribe.
Yeah.
Gang of chicks.
Look out.
Yeah. And actually the school is celebrating its 10th anniversary this weekend, and Mayor Adler has declared March 25th, this Saturday, as Girl Guitar Day in Austin.
Wow.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
no Girl Drummer Day. This is Girl Guitar Day. That's it.
There is a Hug a Drummer Day. So, yeah. I think it's in October.
Drummers get no respect. They really don't.
We've got some badass drummers in the school. So, yeah, the girls from Small Town Girls are also another band that formed out of the school. And there's now probably at least half a dozen performing bands that have come out of that school. And then Cheryl met, you met Christy, one of our two guitarists, at School of Rock, and then at Girl Guitar,
yeah,
right?
Christy and I were in the School of Rock adult house band. We were working with Jason McMaster, who I know, you know, he was coaching that band, and I had met Christy, and then we kind of, you know, just hadn't seen each other in a while, and then now we're playing in this band together.
Awesome. Yeah.
So. And then Sarah McMinn, our other guitarist, I met her about a year and a half ago. We ended up playing on a Misfits Danzig cover band.
It's crazy. You know, the whole thing is, I noticed, like, in the past couple of years, it's like everybody's got a tribute band now, which, I mean, to me, it's kind of cool because you basically know what you're getting when you walk in the door. You know what I mean? Right. It's not your typical, you know, same three sets or, you know, same four sets or whatever people are playing these days, you know. So you know what you're getting when you walk in, which is great.
And it's fun, too. I mean, I've played in original bands. I've played in, you know, playing in this tribute band. And I don't know, there's something special about playing in a tribute band or attending a tribute band show. It really, personally, I think when you're in a tribute band or attending a show, you really can create a production and a performance.
Well, I mean, my buddy, he plays in a Tool band. My buddy Jesse. He plays, they're called Naked and Fearless.
With Ken.
Oh, you're talking about them Monday. Okay. Yeah. You were mentioning.
Have you seen them?
Not yet. I saw them out at Texas Smith's the last time we were there.
Yeah, and Ken plays also in this band called Telephantasm, and it's a Soundgarden tribute. And they were so good.
I want to see them.
They played over at Round Rock Tavern. It was them and the Tool band.
Nice.
Ridiculous. They were so good. So
I saw that where they're it's like a 70s and 90s night, and my friend Ozzy's band, Pretty's for You. It's an Alice Cooper tribute. a mostly female Alice Cooper tribute, except for Ozzy.
Hey, Alice Cooper's got like he's got a great girl guitar player, and actually a couple.
Yeah, so it's kind of actually they he was telling me they retweeted him. The female guitarist retweeted them. Because they were like, she's like, where can I hear this? You know?
Yeah.
But yeah, like I saw that. And then Mob Rules, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, isn't Alice Cooper's guitar player? Okay, there was two of them. One of them is with Oriani. She's the one dating Richie Sambora now. She left Alice Cooper's band.
Yes.
And now there's the girl that plays with the Iron Maidens. She does. Okay. Yeah. She's with Alice Cooper now. Kind of back and forth between the Iron Maidens and that, so
yeah, I'd I guess that because I think when I saw them, it was the other guitarist. The last time I saw them, I think up here at when they were opening for Motley Crue.
Yeah, that was like 3 years ago.
Yeah, it was like 3 years.
Yeah,
ago.
That was the same chick. That was the same girl from the Iron Maidens.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you ever seen them? They're really good. They're like a touring Iron Maiden, you know, tribute kind of thing going on.
Nice.
Yeah, but they're really good. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of them, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's like if I ever came back, you know, out of retirement, I was telling everybody, I would probably come out and this one band you could play anything with. You could do bar mitzvahs. You could do, I mean, weddings. If you got a Rolling Stones tribute band together, I mean, a really good one.
Yeah.
You could play anywhere.
Yeah,
that is true.
And make a ton of cash, a ton of money. Because it's nothing but hits. I mean, nothing but hits.
Well, I'll tell you, my friend Mark in... Mark Daniels in Atlanta, and my friends Nick and Peter have a project that started out as basically performance project and kind of a joke about almost 10 years ago, and now it's like their major source of income. They started a Yacht Rock tribute. It's called Yacht Rock Review, and the players are so good that they started reaching out to all the original artists, and it was funny. They said that like they found... they found Elliot Lurie, who from Looking Glass, who did that song Brandy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he was now representing Disney artists, like trying to find the next Hannah Montana.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I don't know about that.
So, but basically, like, and then.
I wish I was Hannah Montana.
They got rid of, you know, they got a hold of, like, the guys from Player, like, you know, like Ron Moss that used to be on Bold and Beautiful. And they basically just said, hey, you guys want to come down to Atlanta and play a one-off show with us? We'll do everything. All you have to do is come out and sing and play your instrument. And they're like, okay. And they did, and they loved it, and it's worked out so well that they constantly tour back and forth across the U.S.
Wow.
They tour themselves, they tour a couple of other tributes, and then they put together this tour throughout the summer where they pick four or five artists and bring them on, you know, and do a couple of their songs each. It's crazy.
Sort of like the American Idol tour.
Kind of, weird yeah, kind of yeah, kind of, but with like Ambrosia.
Ambrosia. Good Lord, man. I look at some of these people, you know, like way early 70s stuff, Ambrosia. I mean, the only it's like, come on, really?
And then you see her front our band at a show and you're like, no, she doesn't listen to Yacht Rock. There's no way.
Yeah. Sadly, my hard edge, metal edge ends at about the Cult.
Oh, come on.
And well, yeah, my love of metal probably ends with Sunset Strip metal, you know?
Yeah, that's...
But that's about it.
It's funny because, you know, I went through the whole metal thing in the 80s, you know, and part of the 90s. I still listen to it, but I mean, I'm more of a 70s guy now, you know?
Yeah.
Just not Yacht Rock.
Well, it's funny. I'll be like, we'll be like watching TV and, you know, watch PBS or something comes on, and they always have like these, you know, public broadcasting systems, and if, you know, if you send, you know, $50, you get this DVD of the show playing tonight, and it's like Peter, Paul, and Mary, and, you know,
Yanni.
Peter's 95 years old, and the other one, doesn't know where he's at, and, you know, and it's like the Beach Boys with one guy that, you know, is sort of an original member. You know, it's just kind of great. You know, they have like these little
Mike
group
Love's
tours.
Going to do that until he drops over.
Mm. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, but it's all these, I mean, in the, like, you see, like, the Beach Boys and Peter, Paul, Mary and the Mamas and the Papas. I don't think there's anybody left out of that band. Mm-hmm, got one person in it, you know, with three other people. And
still
it's like,
counts. Still counts.
Sort of. One of the Mamas is still
one
around.
One of us is still here.
You know,
It's crazy though. But the thing about it is they're not doing it for the fun. They need the money. That's why they're out there doing
that's
it.
That's a sad thing about
Well, some of them. Some of them. Because like,
Well, the best one was a Sister Sledge. Sister Sledge was out there, right? And it was one of the sisters. I don't think the other sister's around, or she can't dance like she used to or whatever.
Oh, no. I'm sorry.
Did you hear that ringtone?
Was that the Star Wars?
No, that was that was Charlie's Angels.
Charlie's Angels. There you go. Now we're talking some action.
We had one night after a rehearsal, Jennifer started quizzing us on TV themes.
Oh, I kill y'all on that.
I fell miserably. What was the one we got caught up on? It was...
Because I was like, Criminal Minds.
Yeah. Ooh, I don't know about that. I'm good with 70s shows and stuff.
Yeah,
but.
Well, my ringtone is from Charlie's Angels, and so is my text tone.
I'm sure the dudes in the rehearsal studio next door to us were like, what the hell kind of band is this? Murder, She Wrote, and Love Boat.
I watch a lot of cozy TV.
Yeah, well, they still have those on TV?
Oh, yeah.
Golden Girls is still
You got to go to like, the, was it like, what is the name of that?
I DVR a lot of Fantasy Island.
No, what's the name of that channel though? It's got all the retro stuff on
TV
it.
TV Land,
might be TV Land.
TV Land, and then Cozy.
And Cozy. Yeah.
Oh, it is Cozy.
One.
Okay.
Yeah, I remember that was okay. So it was the Love Boat, and then right after was Fantasy Island, right?
Yeah. Sunday nights.
Just so I remember, it was like on CBS. It was like, man, I'm gonna say it was The Incredible Hulk was on first, and then The Dukes of Hazzard was on second. I remember all that shit. Shit, bring it on. I'm good.
See, that was, you know.
And same thing with like All in the Family. And I think Jefferson's was right. No, was that right? No, maybe.
Yeah, like when we were kids, that was the version of reality TV. It wasn't Survivor or like the Celebrity
Survivor
Apprentice.
Ruined TV.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like it wasn't Celebrity Apprentice where you're listening to, you know, people, you know, get made fun of. It was, you know, you tune in and it's like, oh my God, you know, there's going to be people from Happy Days and for the Brady Bunch.
Oh, for right. Right. Fantasy Island or Love Boat?
Fantasy Island.
The Love Boat.
Going to be like, oh, that one too.
Isaac
well, both of
drinks,
them. Yeah. Both of them. You know, it's like, oh my God, look who's guest starring on this.
Who's it like the guy in the Love Boat? Who's one that got all the chicks? It was a doctor. Wasn't it the doctor?
Oh, I thought it was Isaac, the bartender.
No, not the dog. No. Isaac was always lonely. Isaac never got any girls.
Yeah. He had all the liquor, man.
No, it was the doctor. The doctor. What was his name?
I can't remember his name.
Yeah,
I remember
was,
Gopher, but not the doctor.
Aww.
And the girl, she would always, once in a while, she'd get a guy here and there, but, you know.
Julie.
But Julie, yeah. Julie McCoy. Is it McCoy? McCoy or McCoy?
Yeah.
And then they have like, she brought her like her niece on or something at one point, or I don't know, it's been like 50 years ago. No, but it was no. What's the doctor's name? They used to call him Doc, right? It was his Doc.
Yeah.
I don't know.
He had all the ladies. As soon as they walked on the boat, boom.
Sick bay.
That's right, sick bay, honey. He was like the captain. He was like the Captain Kirk of the Love Boat. Yeah. I don't tell you. Yeah, we talk about a lot of crazy stuff at work, though. But we're talking about, you know, all this crazy political climate now. Mm-hmm. If they took a show like All in the Family and put it out now.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man, yeah.
Or like a movie like Blazing Saddles and put that out now.
Yeah.
Ain't going to happen.
No,
you know?
No.
But then we're talking about they should make a remake of Blazing Saddles.
Do you hear they're doing a remake of The Matrix?
Oh, no, that's not real. That's not for real. Is that for real?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Who's in it?
I don't know.
I have no idea.
That can't be real.
No.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Does Keanu Reeves have a kid?
I don't know, man. How are you going to do it? It's sort of like doing Keanu The Godfather over here. We're going to do The Godfather trilogy over. Nah, I don't think so. Really? You're going to do The Matrix over?
Yeah.
That can't be for real.
We already know they're in the pods, and
some
there's a glitch in the
news.
System.
Right. Like, exactly.
Where are we going to go from there?
I don't know, man. You know what? It might be it might be a prequel kind of a thing. I don't think they're going to remake those movies. It's going to be a prequel or an after effect thing.
I don't know. Interesting. It's weird, you know, because it's like, this is stuff that came out when I was like in college.
It's only like 20 years old.
Yeah.
Oh, we could feel young again. I like it.
Yeah, but it's gonna be so crazy. You watch 5 minutes of it and your head will explode. Like, it's like when you go to the theater and you try to watch Transformers. It's like,
yeah, exactly.
Shit,
on the
overload,
IMAX.
Overload.
IMAX.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, high as hell. Just kidding.
On life.
On life. Oh, we talk about every on here. I can't do that anymore, so I can't do anything anymore. Aww. So, yeah, I work for the FAA, so I can't do anything. Mm-hmm. So I just kind of gave up. I had to give up drinking. It was a little nutty there for a while. So, what are you gonna do?
Now you can still have fun.
So, how long have you been playing drums for?
So when I was like 5 years old, I announced to my parents, I want to play drums.
Uh-oh.
And they made me wait till I was in fifth grade. So I like did all the, you know, concert band stuff. So I've been playing since I was in fifth grade. I'd take a break here and there. And I've been playing kit since junior high.
Oh, cool.
We had a basement, so my parents would be like, that's good. Go down there.
Go down there. Dun, dun.
And I'd never hear when it was time for dinner. I'd be down there for hours. When it was time for dinner, they'd have to blink the lights because I wouldn't hear that going down all those stairs.
That's the best way to do it. Yeah. Blink the lights. Studio. That's funny.
Recording studio at a young age. Yeah, so I played. Yeah, so I did that. And I noodled around and, you know, I did all the... I didn't do marching band or anything in college, but I was the band nerd.
I did all that stuff.
I did it all through high school. So yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was really funny how I started was because I wanted to play sax when I was a kid. You know, I was like in fifth grade. My mom goes, I'm not going to go out and rent, because you used to rent stuff back then.
Right.
She was like, I am not going to rent a sax for you because you're going to play it for 2 days or a couple weeks, and you know, you're just gonna give it up. I'm lose all this money, yada yada yada. Mm-hmm. She goes, why don't you just buy you a pair of sticks and a pad, right? And
yep.
Boom, there you go.
Yep.
And that was like 1970 something or other.
Was it that that wooden drum pad, the wood with the rubber on it? No.
The one I had was like I had to draw you a picture of it. It was crazy. But and I stuck with it. I just, you know, fell in love with it. So mm-hmm. I got a weird thing with me. It's like I have that special gift of like natural time. I just mm-hmm. have it.
That's awesome.
You know, yeah. It's like where a lot of people are like, oh, where's the one? Mm-hmm. I'm just like, I could just like sit here and talk to you, and there's the one right mm-hmm. there. You know, I'm like,
yeah.
You know, and that's just the way that I am. Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of crazy gift that I do have.
That's awesome. Yeah. It's a siren, man. It's like a siren. It's like just pulls me in. You know, those drums just pull me in every time.
That's awesome. Good for you. So how long, you're the bass player, right?
I'm the bass player. I've been playing for about 3 to 4 years. So I got started by playing Rocksmith, actually, which is where you actually, it's a video game, but you actually play the real instrument in, not the little fake guitars. And my boyfriend had both a bass and an electric, and he wanted to play the electric with Rocksmith, and you could play two people, so I played the bass with him at the same time and just fell in love with it.
Awesome.
And from there found girl guitar and
wow, that's crazy.
Rhythm section.
The rhythm section.
Exactly. Exactly. And I learned to play accordion when I was eight, between the ages of 8 and 10.
Oh, we're going deep now.
I didn't even know that. We're going deep.
So, my parents thought it would be a real good idea for me to play accordion so that I would then transfer to playing piano. And I was actually really good at it. And I played left-handed, so I had a left-handed accordion. Yeah.
Okay.
So all the keys are over here. All the chord buttons are over here. And... towards the end of the couple of years, it was just that it got harder. I got a larger accordion where there was more chords, there's more octaves, and I wasn't playing with anyone. As like a 10-year-old kid, I was like having to practice like turkey in the straw and crap. You know,
turkey in the straw.
You know,
how does
like
that work? I don't even want to know.
Yeah, in my turkey bedroom, you know, and it just seemed like a chore, a punishment. I was like, I'd rather be outside playing. So I was like, screw this.
Turkey in the straw.
It's like a menu item.
Yeah.
Sounds like a 70s TV show.
You know, like turkey in the straw. You know, the stuff that they play at, like, you know, somebody play on like an organ at a baseball field. I didn't do anything else for 30 years as far as that went, but I was always the drunk girl dragging my friends to karaoke. And I performed acted more in college, and about 7 years ago I joined a national karaoke league.
What, they have those?
Yeah, there's a thing in Austin.
I don't get off that much.
But it's not just straight up karaoke. It is basically karaoke improv, so it's karaoke with a storyline. So I was
karaoke
like,
with a storyline.
Wait. So wait, I can sing and I can dress up. Oh, I'm so there. So it was like basically you'd do a song but you would do like basically a skit or something around it. Like you tell story. Like it was just creativity on steroids. And I won the first two seasons I was in, and then started working for a sound company that did karaoke.
This is crazy.
That's how I met Jim, is working for that sound company. I still work for them on occasion.
Big ups to Jim.
Yeah.
Should call him up. What's up, Jim?
And then I ended up hosting the National Karaoke League as their sound host for a couple of years, because it was like, you do a whole year of that, and it's like you use every good Halloween idea you have for like 15 years, and you're like, I'm done. I'm burnt out.
Sort of like my Halloween costumes. You ever hear about those?
What?
Ooh, do tell.
What do you dress up as?
Well, this is how it works every year. It's got to be a superhero, right?
Oh, Lord.
It's got to have a mask, and it's got to have a cape.
I have an ex-boyfriend like that.
And here's the kicker. I get a kid's costume, but it's got to be a kid's large. So when I put it on, it's like, it's pretty nutty. It's pretty crazy.
I'm sure Crystal really loves being seen with you.
I did Iron Man the first year.
Oh, man.
Superman didn't have a mask. I had a cape, though. So I did Superman the next year, and I did Batman this last year.
Oh, my God.
And it was like, I mean, those little kid costumes are a little tight. And
you got the capris going on.
Yeah. And other areas are a little accentuated. Let's put it to you that way.
I was going to say, I'm sure Crystal loved that.
So, you know, yeah, I was the hit of the party. So, and then this year, we're gonna go full out Wonder Woman this year. So I got to get a Wonder Woman costume.
Oh, God.
Please be sure to
I'll show you
post
pictures.
That.
You'd be like, yes. What the? You'd be like, what?
All of my Halloween costumes are either Disney characters or rock stars. So.
I like superheroes. That's my thing.
Yeah, like I've gone from being like, you know, Alice in Wonderland to Nikki Six. So
it was funny the first year with the Iron Man thing, because I bought, I think it was a medium, and it was like a last minute thing. I'm like, man, I don't have a costume. So I went over to Walmart and I went over to the kids section, had all these, I'm like, I got Transformer over here. I got a Power Ranger. Ooh, there's Iron Man. Iron Man right there. And the mask is like this big on my face.
What did the sales associate say?
He didn't say nothing. But it was like on Halloween day, so it was like, I think it was like $6. So I get it home. I tried to get it. I had to cut it in half.
Oh, my God.
I had to cut it in half, right? And I had to make a belt to hold the pants part up. Yeah.
A little midriff.
Yeah, so I had to wear midriff. And then the back of it was like, a V, because it wouldn't close at the top like this.
Open back.
Yeah, the back. And so I remember after the party.
Sexy.
Yeah, it was crazy. And everybody was like, what the hell? I mean,
who was that master?
I remember Matt Bray looked at me from LC Rocks, and all the dudes from LC Rocks were and stuff. And he looked at me. He goes, you look ridiculous. I said, that's the point, Matt. That's the point. But, yeah, so I remember getting into the car when it was over, and just the back end ripped. Just the pants just ripped. I mean, it was just gone. I just tossed it out.
Oh,
I still have the mask, though.
Nice.
So I think we're going to do a podcast up here one of these nights just with masks on, you know.
Nice.
That'll be cool.
Yeah, but I think the mask was like this big on my face. It's hilarious.
My question is, what 99-cent CD did you grab on the way when you were at Walmart?
Oh, man. I do buy a lot of stuff, man.
No Star Wars.
Man. Nah. I don't think I've bought I think I bought a Metallica CD at Walmart for $5 or something.
Yeah.
No, this guy was buying all. He's just like dipping her. Oh, this looks good. I'll get this. Carole King, you know, greatest hits. Not to say she's bad.
That.
I'm just saying. It's just I don't want to hear that.
Say what's wrong with
Yeah, but you know, here's the deal though. He'll play the same CDs every day, and it's like, okay, the Carpenters. Yeah, you know, I got it's enough of the Carpenters.
I love the Carpenters, but they're kind of depressing.
Oh
so,
yeah, oh yeah. Horrible.
You're at work.
Yeah.
No, I'm moving around a little bit. Thank the Lord. And it's like I said, man, Ron, one of these days that disc is gonna come up missing. I'm not saying where it's gonna go. It's not gonna be here. You know,
it's gonna be a mask for Halloween.
There you go. There's your Halloween. Take all his CDs that you don't like and wrap yourself in them for Halloween.
I can make a costume for each of us.
You can be super many of them. Rock man.
Yeah. So yeah, we're gonna do the Wonder Woman this year.
Nice.
We'll do a nice big frilly Cher wig and everything.
Nice. Nice.
The golden lasso, all that stuff.
Invisible plane.
Well, you know. The invisible plane. You heard about the invisible, what do you call it? The was it the Kiss put out? I know you heard about it.
No,
I listened to
the
podcast.
Guitar
we talk about
strings.
It. Yeah.
Yes.
The air guitar strings.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he's laughing all the way to the bank.
$4 for a pack. This is like it's an empty pack of nothing. Empty pack of nothing. That makes a lot of sense. $4.
Spencer's probably all over that.
Yeah. No, it's a thing they put up in Vegas. They have like this it's like a Kiss mini golf thing in Vegas at one of the casinos. Mm-hmm. And they sell these special swag over there, and that's where that's at.
What, Kiss mini golf in Vegas? And
yeah.
I missed this.
What resort is this at? I was gonna say.
Do you know anything about Vegas?
Oh yeah.
Okay, you know where the old Hard Rock was?
Yeah.
Like you have to go off the strip and
yeah.
Yeah.
Like mm-hmm. right across the street mm-hmm. was like this place that they turned into a Kiss mini golf.
Oh,
and I think it's still over there, but I went to Vegas like last year, and there's a Hard Rock on the strip now. Which I didn't go into. I don't know where.
I haven't been in that one.
I don't know what's up with the old one. If the old one is still, I guess it's still a hotel and casino, I would think.
I don't know.
But they just have a restaurant on the strip.
Okay.
So, but that mini golf is right across the street. So.
There's some good tribute bands in Vegas, too. Like, I've cruised around at the different casinos and the bars and seen
my
some
last
good tribute.
Trip, mm-hmm. I booked my hotel just because I wanted to go see, I don't know what they're called now, but they were called Guilty Pleasures at the time. They were
a Guilty Pleasures
tribute.
Here, wasn't there? An
all-female
yeah, Guilty Pleasures, right?
I think so.
Were you playing there?
Not me.
No. wasn't that Amy's band?
Yeah, it was Amy's band, yeah.
Yeah, no, but this was like mm-hmm. another Yacht Rock tribute. But their calling card was that their lead singer was Michael MacDonald, and the guy did an amazing, and he played sax.
Mike MacDonald.
So yeah, and he did an amazing Michael MacDonald impersonation. And they would, this is the thing. They would redo songs as if Michael MacDonald wrote them and gave them to other bands.
Oh, wow.
So, like, and I was there one night. When some of the guys from, I'm trying to remember where it was it, it was a metal band that happened to be there at Mandalay Bay, and they came up and tipped him $100 to play
what?
It again, wow. To play Enter Sandman, because he has this version of Enter Sandman. As
oh
if
God.
Michael MacDonald wrote it.
Oh, good Lord.
Yeah.
I might cry if I heard that. And a version
of, like, Talk Dirty to Me and, like,
you know what?
It's hilarious.
You know what? Here's the deal. If this guy is spending that much time doing that, why does he come up with some original stuff? You know what I mean?
Because it's so clever.
Well, it's clever. He's making money on the strip. Yeah.
What about the guy? You know, the guys from that do Max Sabbath out of L.A.
That's the best. That's
right?
I was just thinking about them. The Max Sabbath is
yeah.
the best thing ever.
What's the difference?
I was just thinking about that. I was
dressing up as you know Ronald McDonald Ozzy.
Yeah, that's the best.
They were awesome. Mm-hmm. Did you see them when they were here?
I was gonna go. I didn't go, but I saw like I've seen like a ton of videos.
Oh, it was great. It was great. The stage setup was amazing. They had the helium tanks that they'd have at the when we were kids, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, in the 70s and 80s, that would blow up the balloons for the parties. They had taken them and turned them into fire breathing, glowing
nice.
Red eye
what?
Demons.
Nice.
Yeah, it was. Ron McDonald is a demon breathing fire. Mm-hmm. And their roadie, you know, was dressed up as like the guy who'd sweep the lobby.
Oh my God. And,
you know, it was awesome. It was hilarious. And you know, and they change all the lyrics too. So,
yeah,
you know.
They play all the music the same.
Yeah,
it's all these
yeah.
McDonald Land lyrics and stuff.
Yeah.
I was wondering how the guys that play guitar and bass actually how they actually played because they have these big like
yeah, they're giant heads because
yeah.
one of them's like dressed up as Mary McCheese and
the other one's like,
the bass player's Grimace.
Yeah, yeah,
oh
the purple
Grim
guy, yeah.
Alice.
How do you play dressed
it's,
like Grimace?
It's crazy enough.
The
yeah.
They just you know, you just have to do it all by feel, you know.
Yeah, the drummer's Hamburglar, right?
Yes, drummer's
that's
a Hamburglar.
That's
but it was awesome.
Oh, it's
it was
yeah, it sounds
awesome
hilarious.
Show.
Yeah, I know.
Oh my God!
I remember seeing that on YouTube one day because I cruise YouTube all the time just for hee haws. You find some crazy stuff on there, and I saw that on there. I'm like, this is nuts. I can't believe this. I was like, watched a whole like hour and a half show of it.
Oh yeah, it was great. I was glad I was there. Yeah, it was.
Where did they play?
Show. Where?
Yeah, because I remember looking.
They played at Barracuda.
Because I remember I looked up the tour dates, and in for some weird reason, there was an Austin date in there.
Yeah, they played at Barracuda. They had Stabba opening up for them. Have you seen this guy?
Oh, my God.
Stabba?
Some guy. I know one of the guys from the hot, from like, Stabba. he's associated with the Alamo.
I think I know where that's going.
With like, you know, he's part of like Master Pancake, but it's basically really big dudes.
Master Pancake?
Yeah, it's really big dudes who do, you know, metal, very death metal versions of ABBA songs. And and listening to them, I couldn't really, sorry. I'm going to turn that off.
No, it's okay. I was laughing at the ABBA thing.
Yeah. That's great. I couldn't recognize the songs until they got to the chorus. Because, like, we went out recently to see an ELO tribute here. And they were playing afterwards. And it was like, oh, this is Mamma Mia.
And they had dresses on, I believe.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, they're you know, dresses and fake breasts.
Good
and stuff.
Lord.
Big bearded dudes.
People don't know how big ABBA really is and still is.
Yeah.
They're huge. I remember that there were, I can't remember what company it was offering them a tour, and it was like the most money that any band has ever seen in the history of money. I mean, it's been, it was bigger, it would be bigger than any Led Zeppelin reunion, any Beatles reunion. It was, I mean, it was like the money was like, there was talking like about, I mean, they were going to bring in like $1 billion from this thing because it was going to go worldwide everywhere, you know?
And they wouldn't do it?
They were like, eh, not interested.
They could even get a PBS, you know.
Yeah, PBS,
sponsor,
yeah.
For $9.95.
Box set.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, but they were talking like a 2 or 3 year tour to do everything. And they said that the amount of money that it would bring in. But, I mean, you got to realize, they got to be, what, 70 years old now? I mean, they probably don't have the pipes anymore for it either. I mean, you can't sing like that when you're, you know.
And tour life's got to be hard,
Well, not for them. I mean, you know, they'll be flying everywhere and just, you know, be treated like kings and queens. But they just look, eh. I want to do it.
But you're away from your pets and your home.
Bring them with you.
Yes.
Sound like they're torn in a van. You know what I mean? It's not, the, you know, trust
me. There are some people who do that still.
A lot of them. You know. If I told you the bands that do tour in vans now, you'd be like, what? I mean, bands that had like platinum records back in the day are torn in vans now.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like a new TV show. Bands in vans.
Yeah. I like this. Okay, no one. Yeah, let's copy. This is gonna be copywritten by the time. Yeah, this is copywritten.
Better get on it.
Yeah,
that's too funny. Bands and vans. Yeah, I just like, you know, you see like the take a band like, you know, like Skid Row from the '80s.
Mm-hmm.
Bands and vans. You got to realize what a tour bus costs a week.
Yeah,
and they're not, you know, just to make what it costs to get. To rent a tour bus and a driver for a week, they don't even make that now.
Mm, yeah, that's true. Yeah,
bands and vans.
Speaking of Skid Row, I caught a really cool rehearsal video of them on YouTube from back in the day.
Really,
it's pretty cool. Yeah,
I saw them a bunch of times. Mm-hmm. You know, in the early days, you know, because they basically went from, you know. Getting Sebastian Bach, and they got a record deal right after that and went right on the road opening for Bon Jovi on a world tour, and that was boom, you know, they did that whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then they, you know, did the Aerosmith tour. I saw them like 3 times in a matter of a couple of years, you know, opening for big acts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you remember that show that I don't know if you remember, but back in the, I'm gonna say it's like late 80s, Sebastian Bach, like somebody threw a bottle at him or something.
Mm-hmm.
And he jumped out and, like, was aiming for this guy, and he kicked this other girl in the face.
I think I did hear about
and
this, yeah.
All the money he made off that first record went to her. It was, like, $5 million.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, wow.
She sued him, yeah. Mm-hmm. I was at that show.
That's awesome.
It was up, because I'm originally from Connecticut,
mm-hmm.
and that was up in Springfield, Massachusetts. They were opening for Aerosmith.
Mm.
And it's really funny to this day. I sort of remember seeing it, but it was like, okay, you know, he jumped out and he kicked this girl in the face and, you know, really did some damage on her.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because he's a pretty tall, skinny dude, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. But he was a wild man back then. He just didn't. He was like 18, I think. 18 or 19 when we got in that band. He was just like, you know, gave zero, you know. Zero fucks. How's that? We could say that on here.
Nobody
I won't offend anybody.
Nobody knows what to do with it at that age, you know?
Yeah.
You know, like I've been listening, you know, as we were working together the set list, I'm like listening to some of the stuff going, God, Ian was, you know, when Dreamtime was released, he was like 21, you know, and was kind of like couch surfing, and the you know, and then got, you know, signed. And by the time they did Electric, he was 25. And
I'm, well, like, I mean, it's like,
there's no way in hell I would have had shit together at 25.
It's,
you know?
Like, I mean, like Tommy Lee from Motley Crue, he was like 17 when he joined Motley Crue. His first album was out like 17 or 18.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's why he is the way he is now, because he has never had a normal childhood. He's sort of like Michael Jackson.
Right.
Because, you know, I know people that know him, and he says he's like a big kid.
Yeah.
You know, he don't like being told no. He's just that kind of guy, and he's, you know.
I ran into him. I used to run a boutique in Calabasas.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Actually,
before the Kardashians ruined it.
Well, what's funny is before the Kardashians were on the air, they were my neighbors across the street.
Oh no! Were they really?
Yeah. Dash is actually in. There were, you know, two really nice outdoor shopping centers, and Dash was in the not so nice shopping center with the Asian nail salon and the post office.
There was a Dash back then, though?
Yeah. This was like early 2000s.
What did they sell?
Well, same stuff they sell now.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Overpriced junk?
Yeah, basically. It's a boutique. And like the way it was portrayed on the show, I'd go in there and they'd be like hanging out on the couches and just kind of look at me and go, you know, like, all right.
Hey, whatever.
I'm going to look around. But I ran, because that was back when a lot of people were, you know, kind of moving out to Calabasas and Westlake and whatnot on the north side of the valley, because I lived in LA for about 5 years at the end of the 90s, beginning of the 2000s. And like, we had the only, you know, Starbucks in the area and the only Coffee Bean and Tea Leaf and like the only like Home Depot and a couple other things. So, yeah, you'd see weird, interesting people just kind of show up. At one point, we had the only T-Mobile store in the north part of the valley. This is like 2001, 2002. So, like, you know, Angeline, who's, like, famous for being famous. She drives around like a Barbie car. She'd be there, like, every couple of weeks, you know. And then she'd walk into my store and scare, you know, my customers.
That's the thing I don't get about, like, the whole thing today. Because when I was growing up, I mean, you actually had to have some talent in order to be famous. You know, now it's a thing where, you know, you make a dumb video where you jump off a bridge and, you know, you break your leg and all of a sudden it goes viral. Then you're a star. And it's like, I don't understand how this works.
The power of the internet.
It's craziness, though, man. You know.
But yeah, I at one point, Donna DeRico had opened a spa a couple of doors.
Oh, that's
right.
Yeah. When she was married to Nikki.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And I would see her.
That,
like,
lasted about a week, though, didn't it?
Well, it was a couple of years.
Wasn't it really? Because I remember the two of them got it together.
Yeah. And so I'd like see like this blonde woman with very big boobs with like a kid on her hip. And there'd be like four or five other kids. And then there's this like 6'2" guy with a big palm tree, black hair. And I'm like, shit. That's Nikki Six. There was like her spa, and then Howie Mandel's wife ran like a little boutique next door. It was surreal.
Wow.
Yeah. It was
and
very weird.
She gave
weird.
That all up to come here.
Mm-hmm. I was just happy to, like, I was like, these people don't think that I know who they are, but I kind of do, and this is hilarious.
Well, it's like Austin. I mean, you know, there's a lot of celebrities that live here, and they, you know, a lot of them move here to get away from all that, because there's no paparazzi in Austin. I mean, there really isn't.
Right.
You know? Because, I mean, that's one of the reasons, like, you know, Joey Kramer from Aerosmith, like, lives right down the street. He lives, like one exit or one or two exits down in Georgetown. And I tell people, I'm like, what? He lives in, I mean, I run into him, like, I've met him, like, a couple, 2-3 times. Him and his wife live here. And, you know, and he works out over at the Gold's Gym over in Wolf's Branch over here every day. So that's his routine, you know, and it's like, okay, it's a guy from Aerosmith, whatever, you know. Nobody bothers him. That's the whole thing. And, you know, it's like, speaking of, we're going out to LA in July. So I got to go visit some people, my peoples out there, my comedian buddies. So, we're going to have it for about a week.
Nice.
Yay.
You going to go down to the Rainbow?
I want to go to the Comedy Store. That's where I'm headed.
Oh.
I mean, it's the whole thing with the scene out there. It's,
I don't care. I love going to the Rainbow. Like,
I don't know anybody that hangs out there anymore.
Every time I've gone to the Rainbow, I've run into somebody. The first time I went to the Rainbow, it was like the middle of the afternoon, and I'd been watching. Like, I didn't know anything about it. My love.
It was probably Lemmy or something, right? Because he used to hang out there all the damn time.
My love for, you know, metal in particular, or, you know,
well, to a certain point. But my love for hard rock and some metal really came about in my 20s. And, you know, my ex-fiance at the time was a drummer who'd grown up on the Sunset Strip and, you know, was like 16, sneaking in and like, you know, eating off the craft services cart for like David Lee Roth and stuff. But so like we'd go out and yeah, the first time we went down to the Rainbow for like, I don't know, we're there at like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Yeah, there's Lemmy in a corner booth, you know, with a couple of strippers on his lap. And yeah, it was.
Well,
you
lived
like,
at that place.
Yeah, exactly. And we went after I moved here. I went back with this ex's band where they did a couple of dates out there. And we went down to the Rainbow and I was hanging out up front with the guitar player. And I hear this guy come up behind me and it's like, "Hey, Mio," saying that to the guy I was standing with. I turn around. It was Janie Lane from Warrant.
Oh,
and I was like, "Oh, my God."
It was funny. I met him way back in the day. Paul Stanley from Kiss was doing a what the hell was it? It was like a solo tour.
Yeah.
It was like in 1980, I'm going to say 88, 89-ish. And Warrant just like came out at that time.
Yeah.
And Warrant was opening up. And nobody knew who they were. I don't even think the album was out yet. If it was, maybe like maybe one tune, just like, you know, I think Down Boys was out or something like that. Mm-hmm. And they came out. They had all their little white leather get-ups and did the show. And everybody's like, you know, didn't know who they were. So I knew the sound guy at the club. And so... sound guy was like, you know, place is sold out. He goes, "Hey, if you want to stand up, you know, next to me, you know, that's cool. Watch the show." I was like, "Okay." So I stood there, and there comes Janie Lane, just stood up next to me for the whole show, you know. And I'm like, "Hey, you know, I'll move over a little bit more so you can move, you know, so you can get in here a little bit." He goes, "Because I'm good. And he was like, really just real kind of laid back. And but he stood there the whole show, you know.
Yeah, he was a nice guy. He came in.
Real super nice guy. Yeah. I've met him a ton of times after that, you know.
He came in and had drinks with us upstairs. And this was right after he'd been on Celebrity Fit Club. So he looked good. You know, he was good.
Hey, you know what? You hear about what they did for that show?
What?
They made him gain like 20 pounds before he went on the show.
Oh, wow.
Reality.
That's what they do with a lot of those guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They bring them on. You're not fat enough. Mm-hmm. Gain 20, 30 pounds and come back. No, seriously.
That's crazy.
You know,
crazy.
At that point, because this was like. This was like 2005. He was like, you know, he was kind of turning a corner. It was kind of sad what happened after, but.
Oh, yeah, totally.
But yeah, and then like we were there a couple of nights later and some Stretch Hummer pulls up and Be Real from Cypress Hill gets out. And comes over to the same guitar player that I'm hanging out with and is like, "Hey, Mio." And I'm like, "Who do you not know?"
It was everybody.
Yeah, yeah. It's a friend of mine who lives here who used to play with Alice Cooper on the road.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, and I want to say he studied. He went to what was the guitar institute? What was Sarah telling us? He's one of our guitarists, Sarah. He's her teacher, mentor, and he went to school. He went to school with Jeff Beck. That's what it was.
I think
yeah.
that's what it was. Yeah. Yeah.
He's damn, awesome. He's old. seen Jeff Beck lately? Not Jeff Beck, but it was Eric Clapton. I saw a picture of Eric Clapton because. He played at Madison Square Garden recently, and someone from Austin opened up for him. I can't remember who it was. And they showed, like, a video or a couple pictures and a video of Eric Clapton, like, little mm-hmm. Facebook Live thing. I'm like, damn, he looks old. I mean, he looks – I didn't even know it was Eric Clapton until I saw him. I'm like, oh, my God, it's Eric Clapton.
Oh, man.
he looked like a homeless guy because he was just, like, all gray, but he's, like, all scruffy looking. And mm-hmm. I was like, that's Eric Clapton? Really?
Well, it's like that's what Robert Plant used to look like.
Oh, yeah.
Down here.
I never got to see him down here. I was so bummed.
I met him last year at the Austin Music Awards.
Did you?
Yeah, it was fun.
He doesn't live here anymore, right?
He's gone. No. But he had come back in to do the Paul Ray tribute, you know, because Paul Ray passed away shortly before that. So I was working with Sims, volunteering through the show, and we got to kind of go in and sit in on soundcheck, and it was awesome.
Oh, yeah, he's great.
Yeah.
You're all talking about my voice is already gone now.
Yeah, I jinxed you earlier.
You jinxed it, baby.
Oh, man.
I saw this weird funk that I've had for like about a month. I don't know. So it's going to be kind of groggy now. No, but, excuse me. I mean, I'm going to have to cut out for a second. I'm dying over here. Here, you guys, you girls talk for me. I'll be right back. We'll hack up some lungs.
Talks amongst ourselves.
Talks amongst ourselves.
There you go. Just for a minute.
Okay. Oh, my God. Oh, yes. Yeah, so I brought you. Okay. This is from Jim. That's from Jim.
Oh, I was wondering what that was.
Yeah. You want to show that to the camera? So Jim gave me this on Saturday. because he felt that Bobby should have that as well as the poster. I think the poster wasn't bad enough. I'm sure he has that poster around here somewhere.
This would be a great time for Jim to call in.
I know. Hey, Jim, if you're listening, you can always call. You can always call in on my phone. And then I have one of the posters from the show for this weekend.
Woohoo!
Yeah. So, and that is mine, and Kemper's face is on it.
Next to Jimi Hendrix.
Next to Jimi Hendrix. Mm-hmm. There you go. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that should be fun.
And our show again is, we could talk about it again. Oh, yeah. Saturday.
So, Saturday night. Doors, I think Jim is opening doors between 7 and 8. Mm-hmm. And the first band, Small Town Girls, a.k.a. Suze and the Boozers, will start at 10. We're going to go on at 11. And War Pigs with Kimber Mueller singing will be going on at midnight. So.
And if you forget this information, just go to Facebook and look up us, Fire Women.
Oh, yeah. So the way to look us up for anybody who's actually listening out there or sees this later on, it's at Fire Women, plural, cult. And you can find us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. We'll see whatever else comes
and
along.
And now we're on www.do512.com. If you go into the search engine and type in our band name, we have a profile on there. And then any shows we're doing will pop up. So yeah. Just search us.
So, and hopefully there'll be more of those soon. Yeah. So.
And then we also have the show on Sunday.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's right. Independence
yes.
Brewery.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Hill Country Ride for AIDS, and it's going to be tacos and beer out at the brewery outside.
Yes.
Rain or shine, if it rains, we'll
and
go
I think
in.
This is one of the first live shows. Oh, sorry, Bobby. This is one of the first live shows that they've done out there.
It's going to be good.
So, it'll be fun.
I'm sort of back.
Okay.
Sort of kind of.
My voice is shot. Jesus.
Yeah, so because Jim had brought you that lovely poster.
Oh, did you see that? I still have it.
I knew.
Look how wonderful that is.
Get a frame for that.
So because he brought you that, he said you also needed this.
Oh, I need that.
Which is the.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Card for all the guys. Oh, my God. And I went in. Okay, so I stopped out there to get one of our posters because he meant to bring this the last time he was up here. But I stopped in on Sunday after that Saturday. Oh, my God. That place looked like it'd been torn apart.
Really?
There were chairs on the stage and on the drum riser and all the tables pushed up. And I'm like, what the hell happened in here? And he's like, oh, it's girls' night out. And I was like, oh, nice.
Yeah, we talked to him about that, and my voice is gone. Jesus.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
It's all right.
We'll forgive you.
Hey, now. Yeah, I called him, and he told me about, there's 100 women there, and,
Oh, yeah.
So.
Did you hear screaming in the background?
No, we.
I don't know, like after the fact.
I called him a couple days afterwards, so.
Uh-huh. Oh, that was Monday, right?
It was Monday, yeah. When Chris was up here, so. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I went by Texas Miss not only to get this to bring you, which
I will hang that up.
I think it's hilarious. So, the guy who designed this, I don't think is at Texas Miss anymore, but originally he had designed it so that the female vocalist from each band would be on there. And then there were some lineup changes, and then they still didn't remove Kitty.
Oh, come on.
Because Kitty, if Kitty Shearer's out there, hello.
Kitty. Love Kitty.
Yes. And Kitty and Lucky Break were supposed to be performing with us, and then she had some lineup changes and, wasn't able to do the show.
Against that purple.
There you go.
Yeah, can I tell you? So this was, I got invited this year to do... Sean Taurasi's Electric Ecstasy.
That's right. Sean was up here.
Yeah. And that was an amazing experience. It was because basically we got together over like a month and a half and did rehearsals, because there was three sets of songs. And I think there were 14, 16 vocalists, you know, like 7, 8 men and 7, 8 women. And then a whole bunch of basically Austin's best, you know, rock musicians.
Right.
And we get together and do each set, you know, over a weekend and run through everything. And then basically kind of assign out as far as harmony vocals, too. And I've done harmony vocals before. I was part of a harmony group in our music school. So I'm used to that somewhat, but like going in, Kember Mueller is amazing. I'd go up to her and be like, all right, where am I? Where's my one? And she'd sing part of the part for me. And I'm like, all right, I got it. You know, and then like, she could basically just go along as far as any of the three parts and pick it out. And she's in for that show. She's in charge of basically all of the backing and harmony vocals. Okay. It's pretty amazing what she does. And between and in particular between her and Kitty and Amy, you know, for that show, Amy McSpadden, like it sounded amazing. Absolutely amazing. And then it, you know, I was just really happy to be part of it and got to do a song. And I've been invited back for next year.
Yeah, he's been doing it for a lot of years.
Yeah, I think this is like the fifth or sixth year. Yeah, he's been doing it. And yeah, but like that's how I got to meet Matt Bray. I was singing with him.
Who is Matt Bray? I don't even know who that guy is.
But yeah, like that's how I got to meet some of the guys from LC Rocks and Mob Rules and Sad Wings and, you know, a couple other bands, because, you know, we're all hanging out at Sean's house.
It's really weird how everybody is intertwined with each other. It's crazy.
Mm-hmm. It was fun. It was fun meeting all of them. And, you know, that's how I met Rick Clark, who is...
Rick,
if he's out there, is one of my favorite new people that I've met in the last couple of months.
Rick is a cool guy.
He really is a cool guy. So I went up Friday night. I originally started out downtown because I was going to go see my friend Steve O'Brien was kind of rebooting a new U2 tribute called Zoo TV. Since, you know, Mysterious Way has been gone for a while.
Okay.
Steve O'Brien's he plays Phil in, you know, Think Lizzy.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody's it's like this this grapevine of people and all these same bands.
I was going down because it was their first show on St. Patrick's Day, and then you know, I got turned around between the two stages and there was some awful 90s cover band and I was like, sorry.
Awful. Ooh, Jesus.
I'm not a fan of 90s music. I lived through it once, and, you know.
Well, I mean, what kind of bands?
Well, just like 90s grunge, like stuff that was through my college years. I don't really want to listen to that again.
But there's a big market for it though. It's just people like,
oh hell yeah. Yeah, you know, like I mean, now there are you know, there are bars that do 90s night basically like every Saturday night.
We got to
like,
realize, right?
That was not a thing when I was in college.
Because the 80s was like, okay, you go every 20 years, and now we're like in that 20 years where the 90s was like 20 years ago, kind of a thing. That's the new classic rock is the 90s.
Right. Still trying to get used to that.
Yeah. Yeah, when I was growing up, classic rock was like Crosby, Stills, and Nash, and you know, that kind of thing. And now that's, I don't even know what they even consider that, like dinosaur rock now or whatever. That's not even like discussed anymore. It's like, you know.
I was watching a video that I sent to my sister the other day where it was like little kids listening to the Beatles basically for the first time.
Oh, man.
And, you know, trying to decide if they liked it. Oh, no. And then kids that were like, 8, 9, 10, you know, 11, listening to Metallica for the first time. And the reaction.
I liked the Guns N' Roses when you did.
Yeah, and Guns N' Roses. And it was like, you know, what do you think of this band? Some of the kids were really into it, and some of them were like,
I remember when I worked at Dell, there was this girl, like, she used to play hip hop all the time. And I've been out of there since, like, man, 2009? So it's been a good stretch.
Mm-hmm.
I was listening to hip hop all the time. Mm-hmm. So. Like John Lennon came on the radio. I think it was like Imagine or something like that. She goes, and some guy says, you know, like, oh man, I've heard John Lennon in a long time. She goes, who's John Lennon?
Oh,
and then she goes, goes, well, he's in the Beatles. Who the Beatles? Who are the Beatles? Mm-hmm. Didn't even know.
Yeah.
And I'm like going, oh, I guess I'm real old now. You know, if you don't know who the Beatles are, it's like, come on.
Well, there are generations growing up that really just don't have a reference, you know, even
that don't have good parents,
you know, well, like don't have a reference to their parents.
Wasn't like Kanye West had a party or something And Paul McCartney tried to get in, and he was denied entry because he wasn't on a list or some shit.
What?
Yeah, I'm serious.
That sounds familiar.
Sir Paul? Jeez.
Yeah. Paul McCartney could not get into a party because he wasn't on the list.
Wow. I don't know about that.
It's true story. Seriously.
Oh, my God.
I'm not sure if it was Kanye West. I think it was Kanye.
That sounds about right. That sounds about right who it is.
That's awesome.
You know about the Franklin's barbecue story, right, with Kanye?
No.
Did you hear about that?
No.
Well, you know, in Franklin's, there's a big line to get the barbecue, right?
Yeah.
Well, he was in town, I don't know when it was, like a couple years ago or whatever, and he thought he was going to cut the line. And they were like, you know what? There's only been one person that's cut this line. It was President Obama when he came in.
Right.
But President Obama bought everybody's barbecue.
Yeah.
So he said, Kanye, back in line, bitch. And I don't know if he stayed and tried to get the barbecue, but they wouldn't let him up. They said,
wow.
This is in L.A., brother.
Right.
Yeah.
That was probably the year he was doing Fader Fort here. Yeah.
Probably. Mm-hmm. There's that big rumor that he lived downtown in one of the high rises and all that stuff.
Oh, God. There was a kid, I don't know if he was still doing it, but he was trying to earn money, and his parents said, you know, you got to go do chores or whatever, and he was a line holder, and I think it was at Franklin's.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Chair, and you pay him, and he'd hold your spot. I think they shut
that
down.
That's good money.
I think they shut that down.
I'll tell you what, the best money hustle I've seen for kids ever is in Las Vegas.
Yeah.
Where they go out and buy water and they sell water.
Oh, yeah. Ooh. The cool water for $1.
Hell yeah.
Up on those overpass walking things.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what I do.
Next to the guy strumming the ukulele. Yeah.
That's what I would do.
That was pretty specific.
Yeah. Every time I would go, I it was over near, they're all over the place, but it was over those overpasses. Yeah.
I love Vegas.
I do too. I love it. That's my town. I love it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh.
Hello to Sean Shirazi as well. Yeah.
Sean Shirazi.
He's saying thanks for the shout out. But yes, and I am very excited to do that again next year. He did tell me after the show, because I was like, I don't know how that went. But he's like, yeah, you're back in for next year. And we got to have you do some cult.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, really?
Do they have any ballads in it? They got a couple, right?
Well, he was like, I think we need to learn Chow Baby. And I was like, that song scares me. So we don't do that song.
Oh, come on.
I can't employ any vocal tricks, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was the one that came to my mind.
Uh-huh. I was like, oh, God. But yeah, I tell you, the best moment of that show was both in the show itself and then before the show, because we were like, we'd be, you know, if we weren't needed in the front room where everybody was practicing, we'd all be hanging out in the kitchen eating and drinking. And a bunch of us were like, you know, waiting for whatever was going on, you know, drinking in the kitchen. And we hear all of a sudden Rick Clark and Sean Austin and Kemmerer Mueller start singing Love Is on the Way.
I'll tell you what, Sean has got a killer voice.
Yeah, and actually, I was really fortunate enough that Sean sang Without You with me.
Yeah, she is. She's really good.
I couldn't have done that without her. But like, everybody froze and was like, we need to be in the other room. Like, you know, I really didn't even know that song. And I was like, I love this song now. Oh, my God.
Yeah, she's got a new band coming out. It's called Judas and the Beast.
Oh, yeah.
And it's half Judas Priest and half Iron Maiden.
Yes. She was telling me about that. Yeah. And they're playing some of the guys are down in San Antonio and they're playing dates down there.
Well, no, that's a different band.
Oh.
She has a band called The Ripper. They're from San Antonio.
Oh, okay. That's
and that's a Judas
of.
Priest band. I get all this mixed up. There's like.
get the chart out with the markers.
All I know is that this is my home base. I do the podcast from here. That's it. I'm in no bands. You know what I mean? It's my life is simple.
But yeah.
Except for my voice goes out. But,
they were awesome. So yeah, last Friday night after missing Steve's show, I went back up to 2.0 to Hanover's and caught Rock Hard.
That's a weird club.
I liked it.
Have you been over there yet?
I haven't been there, but
I don't know.
I liked it.
I get a weird vibe off that joint. I don't know what it is.
Why?
Just do. Fancy. I don't know.
It's fancy.
It's not dirty enough.
You want to touch the table.
It's
no,
nice.
You know what I mean? It's just.
Yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love going to Hanover's, you know. I've been going to Hanover's for years.
Yeah, I'm used to that place.
But I like 2.0. And They had great lighting system, and the sound sounded good. And then, you know, Rick was like, "You want to get up on stage and sing with us?" Like, okay.
So. Once a Randy was telling me, goes, next time you come up here, you have to play, you know, on my kit.
Yeah.
Play a song or something. You got to, you know, he likes playing there. So.
Yeah. And then Adrian Alvarez from Eclipse was there that night too. So they got him up to sing. It was fun. So, yeah.
It's so funny. Everybody's in tribute bands now.
Yeah. It's a thing to do.
I have met. Well, it's funny because, like, you know, before this.
It's crazy.
I'd hang out. You know, the other people that I know as far as musicians in Austin are all probably part of, like, the singer-songwriter community, a lot that are in Americana and a lot that are in, you know, hard rock, original rock. So, you know, I have good friends who used to be in a lot of bands that played, you know, like Steamboat back in the 90s.
Yeah.
And, you know, or even, you know, further back than that and played Armadillo. But
that's a stretch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I have some.
When did that close up? Like 74?
It was in the 80s.
The Armadillo?
Yeah.
I got here in 91. So.
Yeah, it was in the 80s. But, you know, so most of the time before the last couple of years, I'd be out down at like 1-to-1 and Saxon and Strange Brew and, you know, listen to shows down there. And
1-to-1's a cool club.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's yeah. Nice.
We've mm-hmm. actually gotten to play there, you know, mm-hmm. as part of Girl Guitar a couple of times now.
Well, and I mean, a lot of those clubs are popping up. I mean, and, you know, the stages are bigger. Mm-hmm. You know, the PAs are better. The lights mm-hmm. are better.
It's comfortable.
Yeah, because back when I got here, there's a bunch of dumps, you know.
Yeah.
Well, there, I mean, seriously, there's just dumps. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the bar owners wanted to make a ton of money, but they didn't want to put any money back into the club, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's not Greg and Destiny, I can say that.
Oh, no, I'm not saying, I'm just saying, but there's, you know, yeah, like, a lot of the clubs, like, mm-hmm. like, you know, I mean, even, you know, Texas Mist, you know, I mean, they're putting, you know, some money into that club.
And, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think this is, like, the second or third location for 1-to-1, and they've been in this location now for about, I think, 5 years.
It's a good spot, though.
And they've, like, redone all the soundproofing mm. and, like, when, you know, Scott's club closed down, well, Scott exited before it closed down, but when Strange Brew closed down, it was kind of like, this is the real big listening room, that in Saxon, you know, mm-hmm. which is nice because they're across the street from one another. But, mm-hmm. like, honestly, they probably the two best, you know, places as far as listening rooms in Austin.
I haven't been in a Saxon in a while. It's been a long time. I don't get down there. I don't get down that far.
Killer sound.
Yeah.
That
That's
much.
My neighborhood.
Is it really?
Yeah. Yeah. I live, you know, basically half a mile from Music Lab on Old Wharf.
Wow.
Yeah.
Good for you.
So coming up here to, like, you know, yeah. South Dallas.
South Dallas.
I get,
you know, Waco, South Dallas. I get all this kind of crazy stuff. Mm. Yeah. Eventually what I want to do is I want to kind of, like, move it maybe into, like, at least into Round Rock. At least okay. down here. Get, like, mm-hmm. a bigger studio and stuff. But, you know. For yeah. now, this is where it's at. So, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
Well, I come up here on occasion because the sound company that I work for, I still work for as a wedding DJ on occasion. And one of the venues that we do is up here in Georgetown.
Which one's that?
The Page House, the mm-hmm. Victorian that's right on I-35.
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. So, cute place.
Yeah. Well, but we don't have much up here. I think we got like...
An IKEA on the way.
That's yeah. Round Rock, though.
That's Round Rock.
You got down, but you got that whole downtown strip, which is pretty.
Yeah,
nice.
There's, but there's not any clubs. It's like a little.
Not in Georgetown.
It's like Walton's Mountain kind of a thing, you know, yeah. back in the 30s.
I heard a band once. One time, I was down there strolling around for the holiday stroll they do.
They have let me interrupt you. They have a, man, what is it, like a poppy festival or something?
Yeah, they have a poppy fest.
Is it a poppy fest? Yeah. And they have, like, they kind of quarantine off that whole area.
Quarantine, I love that. Back away, there's well, going to be some rock and roll.
Nah, but they always have like country bands, you know?
Okay, bluegrass.
I think Kevin Fowler played it one time or something like that. Yeah. But, I mean, besides that, there's Hardtails across the street over off 35.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's a pretty decent venue. It's not bad. They have a really, like, if you ever, you know, been there and been in the backyard part of it,
mm-hmm. yeah.
it reminds me of how Stubbs is.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's got a nice big stage in the back.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I remember when, and it was funny because I turned LC Rocks onto that place, you know, back, I don't know how many years, 4, 5, 6 years. And the first time that they played it, they got like 600 people went to that.
That's awesome.
600 people over at Hardtails?
No, the whole back. The back was filled. It was like 600 people. Yeah.
Wow.
So they made a killing over there. I didn't get any money off it, Matt, but
yeah, where's this man's
booking
fee?
My cut, yo. No.
And then there's interest. It's been 6 years.
Yeah, it's been a long time. Some money going on here. You can't pay me with drinks no more, son.
Want to see cash?
Yeah, but there's that place, and there's like the office lounge.
Yeah,
I think.
The office. I've been to the office lounge on many occasions.
Old Smokies.
Yep. Well, yeah. Kind of a toss up between that and Texas Bar and Grill. Which one's worse?
No, there's one. It's one in Pflugerville.
As far as smoking.
Yeah. Across from Hanover's. It's, what is it?
Marshalls or
Marshalls.
Red Roosters?
Okay, Marshalls. Yeah. Woo!
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Welcome to unincorporated Williamson County.
Well, because our friends, the American Gypsy Band plays here all the time.
Yeah.
And that's where we go see them. And it's like, oh, man, you're in there just die. You leave with emphysema by the time you get out of cancer, one or the other, or both. Every time you go in that place, it's horrible.
This is where your Halloween masks are going to come in handy.
Yeah, well, I don't have any filters. There's no filters on them, though. Horrible.
I can't imagine playing in that, you know? Like, I just can't. I know. Wasn't that thoughtful,
so,
Jim?
So, what the... I mean, was he handing these out?
He gave that to me and said that you needed that.
I don't need this. I really don't need this.
You need
what am I going to do with it?
I don't know. You need more souvenirs.
Yeah.
I need some more sap. People are going to come in here and think I'm like, you know, fucking super gay. Girls night out.
Well, I think that tour is also coming to, I think it's they're doing a stop at Hanover's too.
No,
nah,
I'm good. I'm good. I don't think I need to go see that. I'm good.
More chairs and tables turned over.
Yeah, they talk about the guys. The women are the worst ones.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the guys. Oh, yeah. Talk about the girl. Oh, yeah. Well, the guys go to strip bars. Oh, yeah. They're animals. No.
No.
They're horrible. Yeah, because I had a buddy that, I'm not going to mention his name, but he...
You'll tell us after you shut off.
Yeah, I'll tell you. I think he still does it in town. He's my age now, but he had this thing called... I think it was called Bad Boys of Texas,
I heard about those guys. Yeah.
Well, anyways, they did... If you know where the... I think it's Perfect 10. That strip bar Perfect 10 in Round Rock? Well, that used to be two bars. And when you walk in, the left-hand side of it was like, they would have, you know, the male dancers like once a month or once every couple of weeks or whatever, and the girls would go in there. So we were going to go out one night. He goes, yeah, man, our show gets over at 10 o'clock. Come pick me up, right? So I get there at 9:30. I get there at 9:30, and I'm like, hey, where's so-and-so? Oh, well, he's in the back. I'm like, yeah, you go back. There's no problem. The stuff that the guys were doing to their shit to make it look big was like, I don't even want to get into it. Was like, what the fuck am I looking at? Like,
traumatized.
So anyways, I went out after that was done, and I sat in the back, and it was like, I can't believe that these women are getting arrested. I mean, it was like, no, I'm serious. I mean, serious, crazy shit. I mean, like, stuff like, what?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I was playing in a band at the time, playing out around town, and the stuff that we used to do was crazier than that. But in a club, it was like, if like guys tried to do that kind of stuff, jail.
Yeah.
But they were actually getting away with it. I mean, you know, and they had a bachelorette party there, and whipped cream comes out, and a little curtain above them, and you know, sorts of nutty stuff. I was like, going, what?
Crazy. What is like in Vegas, what happened there stays there.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, but yeah, so, you know, I got to see firsthand what happens, and it's like, man, it's, I don't know, whatever, you know. And the funny thing about it is a lot of those guys are gay, so it's like, you know, like the Chippendales, a good majority of the Chippendales guys are all gay, all of them. Mm-hmm. So you see these big, you know, burly dancing around, and, you know, they're, you know. They're
like,
all dating each other.
It's just a job.
Yeah, it's just a job.
It's just a job.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So there's my story, and I'm sticking to it. So thank you, Jim, for your little poster there. Well, at least I got something I can hang up. At least I can hang this up.
Yes.
Yeah, the dude card there. I'm going to, I don't know. I know the person I'm going to give that to.
Well, when Jim was
he
up,
loves the dudes.
When Jim was up here and you were asking him, is there anything for, you know, guys to come out and see? And I'm like, Jim, there's an all-female tribute next weekend. And he's like, sorry, I forgot the poster.
He walks in. He comes to my doorway with this thing, right? And he just hands it to me. And I'm like going, what am I going to do with this? I mean, hang it up. Am I going to hang it up? I mean, it's cool. I could, like, you know, hang like stuff up. I love for people to bring stuff up, you know. But it's like, yeah. I'm not gonna. Yeah. So I was talking to Crystal. She's like, "Hang it up, man. Just hang it up."
Start wondering why she's hanging around here all the time.
Yeah. Well, that's what I told myself. I was hanging up in your office. How about that?
You should just only put it up when Jim comes by.
Yeah. Well, put it up and you put Jim's face on that body.
We had a. I'll tell you, we had a blast when those guys were up here because we're talking about I can't remember who got nominated to grease the guys down. I think it was Jim.
That was on Monday, yeah.
No, but it was, we were talking, when Jim was up here, we were talking about, hey, I said, who's the guy down at, who's one of the employees that gets to grease the guys down with baby oil and stuff? And he's pointing to, you know, one of his guys.
One of his guys that he hired to book for him. Yeah.
Hey, did you see what happened to his sound guy? Got into a mosh pit, got a big gash on his head?
I think I did see
that.
Yeah,
it's like, ooh.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Jim has quite the spectrum of shows out there. Mm-hmm. It cracks me up.
That was the funny thing about that club is, you know, I thought it was like a speed metal club when I first saw it because all he had was like death metal, speed metal bands down there.
Yeah. Well, originally when he went out there, because after he stopped working as the doorman at Egos,
Where was Egos?
Egos is the karaoke bar that's right there at Riverside and Congress. Mm-hmm. It's still there.
Okay, I'm just trying to remember.
It's like an underneath an apartment building.
Mm-hmm. I think you're talking about.
Like 10 years ago, it was a live music venue. And then it became a karaoke bar.
A karaoke bar.
And it is probably still the, like they get, you know, rated as far as the best karaoke in Austin, you know, every year. Because it's probably because it's the one that's closest to downtown. And it has a really quirky vibe. You know, it looks like it's like somebody's 70s basement inside, but in a really good way, you know. And it's a fun place. Like there's all sorts of people that come in there. You know, like you go out on the weekends and you're looking at like a couple hour wait.
Wow. Really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm in the wrong business.
Yeah.
I'm in a karaoke bar.
Yeah. Karaoke bars are lucrative business, you know, if you run them right. But yeah, after Jim stopped doing that, I think he first went out to work at Texas Mist. And at that point it was also a karaoke bar and maybe kind of like a Tejano dance club.
Well, that's what it was originally though.
Yeah. And then, you know, he started trying to bring in more, was kind of downplaying the karaoke a bit and trying to bring in more live acts. And then when he had the opportunity to buy it, you know, he was trying out a variety of formats for a couple of years. You know, before he was like, I just really want to run, you know, a rock club.
Oh, yeah. His whole thing was the back room. He wants to make it like the old back room.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That was a killer club.
Yeah. And, so you know, it has, you know, like it's a fun feel, like going out there to see shows. It's a lot of fun.
I can't wait to go out. I think I'm going out in the first, I think.
Yeah.
That's what I'm going out.
Who's playing out there on the first?
Like I look at the calendar now. Like stuff. It's just crazy up here. It really is.
Yeah. Who's
you guys follow?
Who's playing out there on the first?
I think Broken Teeth is playing. Litz Bomb, and I think 333 is opening.
Cool.
It's like four or five bands.
Isn't there an anniversary show or something
like
that?
I think you might be right.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
It's a lot, like I said, with me, there's so much going on with so many bands. It's like, I just can't keep track of anything anymore, you know?
Yep. You need the chart. You need a chart on the whole wall.
I'm going to do like a family tree of everybody. You know? I'll tell you what, it would be like one of those, you know, I'd say inbred families, but it's sort of kind of like that because, but a lot of the people play with, you know, bands together. You know, like Jason McMaster plays in like 25 bands.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's one of those things.
And different costumes too.
Did you see the one for the priest band?
Oh, yeah, for Saturday.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That was quite the getup. I saw some of the video for that on their page.
I want to go see the De Niro Smith.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, because Dave Beeson's a good friend of mine. He was telling me about, you know, the whole De Niro Smith thing. So
that's gonna be good.
I don't know why they're calling it De Niro Smith. I get no.
Because they're gonna make a lot of De Niro.
Is it like he's dressed as De Niro? Like
I don't know. That's what I was kind of going, huh? I don't get it.
I mean, De Niro Smith. That could be kind of funny.
It could be. Who knows?
That could be kind of funny.
I don't know if they play all that much though, because broken teeth, dangerous toys, the priest band. What's that thing called?
Sad Wings.
That Watchtower.
Well, I mean, I don't think he's doing Watchtower much anymore. Okay. I remember seeing him with like Godzilla Motor Company back 25 years ago. So he's got it's like he's got so much stuff going on. He's busy all the time, playing somewhere with something. I don't know how people, for me personally, I don't know how people, like, especially for drummers, how they can like learn all that material and kind of keep it all separate. You know what I mean?
Just start busting out. Oh, wait a second.
Oops, wrong band. Wrong band. Am I right, though? Am I right?
Yeah. I'd have trouble with that. I got asked to audition for a couple of bands last year as a keyboardist. And I was super flattered, but one of them, you know, I went and saw the show and I was like, this is awesome. I actually played some of this stuff, you know, whereas an 80s cover band, and they're great. But I was like, there's no way this would, you know, like I would stress myself out so much trying to learn all this. And then the other one was like an original and cover band that was like 40s, 50s kind of pinup feel.
Huh.
And they were like, yeah, we're going to do a show in 2 months and it's going to be 3 sets, 20 songs a piece. And I was like,
ooh.
Oh my God. I was like, I'd love to say that I could do that, but I'm good trying to learn a few songs at a time right now. I'm working on covering some NXS.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. I'm working on covering some NXS.
Is that the next band? The NXS band?
Well, like I still, you know, a couple of us still are in, you know, like, classes as far as just, you know, to learn something. So like I used to do a couple of band classes where one I'd sing in and, you know, just sing, and then the other I'd play keys and sing. So when we started, you know, playing out, I was like, I just want to have, you know, one spot where it keeps me going as far as what I'm learning.
Right.
So, you know.
So you're just doing vocals in this band then?
In this band, yeah. I do vocals and percussion.
Tambourine.
Uh-huh.
She's a percussion player.
I have a triangulus.
Ding, 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 ding.
I am very grateful to my percussion tutor over the last couple of months, who actually was in Timbuk 3.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Courtney Dane. And
are they still around?
No, but Courtney's
only two of them, right?
Yeah.
It was just like the husband and the wife thing?
No. I mean, there were more people in that band.
I'm trying to think. Who was the band that was? They had I think the guy played guitar. The girl sang, and they had a boombox for the rest of the tracks or something.
God.
I think it was them.
Well, Timbuk 3 was enough. There was more people to that band. He was their, you know, percussionist and sometimes played bass.
Who was the one that did? What was their big song?
Future's so bright, I gotta wear shades.
That's the one, yeah.
Yeah.
I think for the video, there's a video of them playing that, and I think he's just playing guitar and she's singing, and they got a boombox with like the drums coming out of it or something.
Okay.
Sounds something like that.
But yeah, like he's told me stories about like opening up for Sting, and like, oh my God. But he got me through the first couple of months that we were doing this and learning to play gospel tambourine.
Gospel tambourine.
She's hard. She is an awesome tambourine
player.
It's
hard.
I'll tell you what.
What is gospel tambourine?
It's just,
if I can ask.
There's a lot of accents, and there's just a lot of changes and trying to get smooth changes between, you know, different, you know, rhythms. So a lot like playing drums.
Sort of, kind of.
I'll tell you what, as a drummer, it's so fun to perform with Jennifer because she's playing the tambourine and learning that, she understands a bit more about what I'm doing back there.
Yeah.
You know, and it's fun. It's
always
fun,
calling out
know.
Cymbal hits.
Yeah.
Cymbal hits.
She's focused on the cymbal hits. Yeah. Yes. You got to do that at the show. You got to do your...
we're running through stuff off of electric, and there's a lot of, you know, smash and grab, and then there's a lot of directional stuff that if you're listening to it in stereo, you can tell that, you know, they're going back and forth. And I'm standing there singing
from Born to Be Wild.
Yeah, and I'm like, hit, yeah. hit.
When you're a drummer with this girl, you got to hit that cymbal where it is, because she knows where those cymbal hits are.
Well, you know, a lot of that I like to focus on. I couldn't do it myself.
I mean, if you're going to play that's a big pet peeve I have with people that play in cover bands, is they don't play the songs right.
Yeah. Right. Well, you know, there's a difference
There's
a difference between cover bands. You know, cover bands to me are people who do like a general theme, and then, you know, they'll play for a couple of hours most of the time.
Yeah, I know. But, you know, like, I know, like, guys that will go out and, like, okay, let's take Journey, for instance, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
First of all, you know, Steve Smith is a monster. He's, like, one of my favorite drummers of all time. The guy is just phenomenal, you know. And the stuff that you hear on all those big hits, it's, mm-hmm. like, it's got to be played a certain way.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And there's a lot of people that play it. They kind of get through it, but they're not playing it right. And you mm-hmm. can totally hear... You know, it just kills the song because it's not right.
That's that hook that you're listening to.
Yeah, you listen to the Don't Stop Believing, all that Tom stuff and everything.
Yeah,
with the accents.
Yeah.
There's not many people that play that right. Mm-hmm. And I have a drummer friend of mine, Frank. He plays in Jokerville.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Frank Kriege, good friend of mine. Great drummer. He's the kind of dude that, you know, he practices 3 hours. You know, he plays in a cover, but he doesn't even do original music.
Mm-hmm.
And he practices a couple, 2-3 hours a day, but he goes and he tears apart those songs, and he mm-hmm. listens to them, and he learns the correct way to play them, mm-hmm. you know? And so when you hear him play it, like, mm-hmm. that's it. You know what I mean?
Exact. Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. That's when I hear people play AC/DC, and it's mm-hmm. just, that stuff, I'm not saying it's simple,
yeah,
but it's so groove-oriented, and mm-hmm. it's... And if you're a drummer, we're going to talk some drum talk.
Mm. Occupy yourself.
No, but this is true. But this is totally true. Uh-huh. And every time I see somebody do this, I'm like, you don't know the song. Is if you look at the original drummer of AC/DC, Phil uh-huh. Rudd, he didn't have a ride cymbal. Mm-hmm. Everything is on the hi-hat. Mm-hmm. Everything. Mm-hmm. So when you see some guy playing on the ride cymbal on AC/DC, it's like, you didn't know they're playing it right. That's what, and they lose that vibe because,
mm-hmm. yeah,
you know. So when you see Frank play it,
mm-hmm. he's there.
Yeah.
He's like, what ride symbol? I don't know what you're talking about.
But that's
about.
What the thing is. Yeah. But maybe the newer AC/DC stuff that he's not on, mm-hmm. you know, it's different. But mm-hmm. when you go to learn, if you're going to play an AC/DC tribute band, you just take that ride symbol, just throw it off. I'm just saying, just take it off your kit.
Yeah.
And just, it's just all hi-hats, all it is.
Yeah. And you're so right, though. When you take that hi-hat and you can, it's so much groovier. That ride symbol, you crash that and it's.
Yeah, but if you listen to AC/DC, it's just pure groove. That's all it is. Mm-hmm. It's just groove music.
Yeah.
Same thing with the Cult. Cult's got the same thing going on too.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah, I spend a lot of time watching old concert footage before everything was tuned down half a step. Or a whole step. But yeah, I watch a lot of concert footage from like 85, 86, 87, you know, and because, you know, a lot of people will go through and try to sing stuff, you know, like the original recordings. And it's like, you know, that's cool. But I'm also really interested in, you know, how is it being performed?
But even those guys can't sing it like they used to. You know what I mean?
No, but you know, some of that stuff was just created once in a studio, and that's it. You know, but if you listen to them live, they do it the same way live every time.
I'm trying to remember seeing the last time I saw the Cult was.
Did you see them when they were here at Stubbs in 2015?
I saw them at Stubbs. I saw them at Auditorium Shores, and they played for South By.
That was 2012.
Was it?
2011.
It was a while back.
2011, 2012. I was front row center.
Yeah, because I remember Nikki Six was in town for that, and they made a big deal about him being there or whatever.
Well, they brought Matthew McConaughey on stage to play some.
Oh, that was over at Auditorium Shores.
Some screwed up bongo.
Oh, he was drunk off his ass or high. I think he was high off his ass.
during Rain. I'm like, really? I don't think this really has anything to do with that song.
Well, that was right around the time that he got popped for. He was naked playing the bongos.
Oh, yeah,
That was like a couple months before.
Yeah.
Or probably, a couple months after.
Yeah.
So that's why they brought the bongos on stage, just because it was like he was just going, okay, well, you know, I got nailed and, you know, whatever the deal
He's
was.
He's going to own it.
Yeah. He just said, forget about it. I'm, you know, I might as well have fun with it, you know? Because that's what he was known for a lot of years after that, was that whole bongo incident.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. Over in Tarrytown.
Tearing it up in Tarrytown.
What's the deal with that? Was he like some, like, it was, he was like butt naked with another guy and they were like in his living room?
I missed that. I remember he was butt naked and someone called for a sound violation or something.
Yeah, but he was with another guy.
Oh, I missed that part.
Yeah, I think he's just drunk running around, basically.
No, but they were playing bongos.
Yeah,
but he was all butt naked playing bongos.
Right.
It's funny because his mother lives over in Sun City.
Oh,
and I see her over at the HEB all the time. And if she goes in there, she holds court, you know? Yeah, she does. Because what the Sun City people do, you know, you have to be like 55 in order to live there. And I'd love to live there because it's a really swinging place.
But only one person has to be 55 to live there.
Is it? Something like that?
Yeah. You have some interesting couples out there.
Well, I know they got a ton of rules. I know that.
Yeah.
So I remember one time she was there and he was there with her. And it was at the point where he had to lose all that weight for that role. He was like a skeleton.
Yeah.
And what do you call it? She rolls with like probably 5 or 10 women at a time. They just go in there to go shopping, So one day I was over there and they were walking up the aisle and I was kind of walking down and he was talking to this little old lady with his mother, you know, that lived in Sun City. And she's like, because, oh, Matthew, I loved you in Magic Mike. That's one of my favorite movies. And she must have been like 80, 85, 90 years old. And he's just like, yeah. And he caught my eye when I was walking by and he's like, you know, just kind of like that.
Nice.
But I did meet him one time, and it was a pretty bad experience. I don't know if I should tell it on the air though.
Yeah,
it wasn't bad. It was, I'll tell you later.
Okay, when the mics go off, we'll talk.
Yeah, I don't want to. It's not. It wasn't. It was. It wasn't. He would. No, he was totally 100% a great guy. Mm-hmm. It was just the situation that we were in.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think I want to go there.
Okay,
but it had to do with the guy. Remember the guy, the Bachelor?
Yes.
The twin brother Bachelor guys?
Yes.
Had to do with that.
Oh, Lord.
Mm. Yeah. were they here? The Bachelor guys.
Dun, dun, dun.
No. Hey, so let's pimp those dates again.
Okay. So please
pimp 'em.
Come out this Saturday night, March 25th, to Texas Mist. Doors open around 7 or 8, and Small Town Girls, Journey Tribute will be going on at 10, Fire Women will be going on at 11, and War Pigs will be going on at midnight. And then if you can muster, come on out and see us.
Muster.
Come on out and see us on Sunday afternoon. We'll be playing at Independence Brewery. We have Nicole Wagner opening up with an acoustic set, and we'll be going on between 3 and 4.
Awesome.
Yes.
Free tacos.
Yeah.
No, not free.
And like us on Facebook.
Yes.
So oh, that's another thing, too.
We're on Facebook,
again,
Instagram. Yeah.
At Fire Women Cult.
Fire Women Cult.
And if you're already on YouTube checking this out, Jennifer, tell them we have a YouTube channel.
Oh, yes. We do have a YouTube channel.
Damn.
Yes.
We're all over
it.
That's
got it going on.
Fire Women, an all-female tribute to the cult. We're on Facebook, Instagram, mm-hmm. and Twitter as Fire Women Cult. And then, yes, I think the YouTube channel is just
Fire Women Cult.
Fire Women. Is it the same thing?
I think it's
Something like that.
If you search Fire Women, you'll find it.
Yeah.
And we're also on the website do512.com. If you hit the search little magnifying glass dealy and you put our name in, a little profile will pop up on us. And then any shows coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
That we're featured in.
So, yeah, we're working on other shows for the end of, April, and then maybe something in June, and then hopefully something else will pop up.
How come there's not a Pat Benatar tribute band?
I don't know.
What's up with that?
Is that wishful thinking?
Why not?
Would there be enough to fill an hour?
What?
Oh, you just hit a chord.
Man, that's messed up.
I'm just saying.
That's messed up. What are you talking about? Just had a lot of hits.
Okay.
A lot of hits.
Okay.
Really? You don't think so?
Well, you know.
Man, I'll tell you what. You know why a lot of people can't sing that stuff? She's bad.
That's what I was going to say.
You know, I'll tell you one.
Where are you going to find the singer for that?
Yeah, really.
Right.
I'll tell you one person I did see. At, I actually bought tickets to go see her. Was over at La Zona Rosa. It was probably like 10 years ago. It was Cyndi Lauper.
Oh my God, I saw her at ACL. That's my hero. I saw her at ACL Live. Oh my God.
I'll tell you what, she blew my doors in. I couldn't believe how good she was. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she got kind of pissed at me though.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, she didn't say nothing to me, but I was in the crowd at La Zona Rosa, and man, this is like, you're talking 10 years ago, so cell phones are still kind of, I don't know, they're like, they're pretty. It was they were still pretty. Not like they weren't as like prevalent as they are today.
No,
but you know, people still had them. Mm-hmm. But so I actually was, hey, I'm at Cyndi Lauper. When you know she's out there, you know, everybody's just sitting there. I'm like, and she like looked over me like this. And I was like, I gotta go. I knew she saw me. But she was like, when you walk in the place. It's like, no smoking will be allowed at this show. I mean, and some guy tried to light up and they just walked him out. Yeah. Because she's like totally against that stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, she's from Brooklyn. She's, you know, she don't put up with any kind of shit. So, I mean, yeah. Yeah, but I'd love to see someone do that, you know, a Cyndi. And, you know, but that's the thing, too. I mean, if she had some hits, but I mean, she didn't have, you know, enough to fill an hour, I don't think.
Yeah.
But Pat Benatar, come on now.
I don't know.
Benatar's got Pat Benatar's greatest hits album. That's all you need.
The hits, nothing but the hits.
Well, you know what's really fun. You know what's really funny though is, like, I had an argument with a buddy of mine probably about a year ago about Rick Springfield, right?
Pro or con? What side were you on?
I was on the con. And he was like, he was telling me, he goes, man, you don't even know the hits that guy had. I'm like, what? Yeah, Jesse's Girl and that, whatever, you know.
Don't talk to strangers.
Come to find out, he had a shit ton of hits. And, you know, but then he wrote for other people, too, which I didn't know.
Yeah,
right. So.
That's true.
So, I don't know. Mm-hmm. But you don't see a Rick Springfield cover band, though.
No.
Well, every band in this town pretty much is.
Every
80s band
does Jesse's Girl.
And girls just
want
to have fun.
God. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, man, if you got a nickel for every time some cover band played that. Oh, God. Every time I hear that opening riff, I'm like, oh.
Great. Thanks. Now that's going to be stuck in my head all night.
Not even that. It's like I want someone to stab me in the face with a fork or something. Like,
that
I'm
one.
Done.
That and Your Love.
No, the ones that get me.
Please.
I'm going to go through them. I'm going to go through them. These are the ones the cover bands play that I cannot stand. Get ready for this list.
All right.
Jesse's Girl's number one. I don't even know the name of this song. I know the lyrics. Josie's on a Vacation
Far
Away.
Yeah, that's Your Love. That's Your Love.
That one.
There you go.
Pour Some Sugar on Me.
Yep. Sorry, Matt Bray.
You Give Love a Bad Name. All great songs. I don't want to hear them every time I go out. What else? There's a bunch of them, you know.
Anything by the Black Eyed Peas?
No, I mean I'm talking like, you know, those standard rock hits that, you know, everybody
plays.
For a while there, that
was standard fare.
I think you Give Love a Bad Name is probably one of the popular ones. But no, pour Some Sugar on Me's got to be number one. It's got to be number one. Just drop it. Just drop it.
Don't pour the sugar. We're good.
No, it's like Def Leppard's been around for what?
Keep your sugar.
I mean,
keep it to yourself.
I mean, Def Leppard's been around for 40 years. They got a lot of good songs. Can't you play something else?
Yeah, exactly.
Anything. I don't care.
I got one. Take on Me.
Oh.
Nah.
Yes.
I don't hear that one very much.
Oh, I hear it a lot.
Really?
Yeah. Take on Me and, what's the other one? Let's Go Crazy. I really don't need to hear anybody else put your prints. I hear that a lot.
No, I don't think I've heard that one too much.
I haven't heard that as much, but I like that one.
I like it too, but, you know.
She likes the Prince version.
Yeah.
I love the Prince version.
Yeah.
I don't know. No, but I think the Jesse's Girl and the Pour Some Sugar on Me, I could do without those.
Yeah.
So if I ever played in a band again, ain't happening.
It's gonna be in your contract. Yeah. Not play this.
No, but I heard
it's like being in a country band and saying I'm not playing Picture.
Picture? What the Kid Rock song? I love Kid Rock. What are you talking about?
I
do. I really love Kid Rock.
He's got the CD right there.
I love Kid Rock. I love Kid Rock. I was like, you know, when the whole Ba with a Ba thing came out, I'm like, I'm on this. I saw the end. I remember sitting in my living room, and I'm like, man, I got to get this right. This is pretty good. That was when the rap rock thing was, you know, like Limp Bizkit and all that shit came out. Mm-hmm. I was like heavy into that for like about a year or two. Some cool stuff. I mean, some cool stuff. It was different, you know? Good stuff. She's like, what are you talking about? I don't hear anybody playing Limp Bizkit. How about that?
Yeah. Limp Bizkit tribute band.
There you go.
Oh, God. Oh, God. No.
That'd be awesome.
No. Just called Nookie.
Just call it Nookie. That'd be the best.
Oh, my God.
I got a plethora of great ideas. I don't know how you guys want to pick them up.
Write this down.
Nookie. Are they still playing? They're still around too, aren't they?
I think so.
I don't know.
But you know what's funny is I actually have heard like there are some like it's just more general cover bands, but there are some bands that start to like cover that stuff like the way that you know like 80s and 90s cover bands cover things. I'm like, oh God.
Yeah, but at least
that
but
like
at least
torture.
But at least they're doing something different though. That's what I'm saying. You know.
Yeah.
It's the whole thing, man. It's like if you're gonna go out and play some tunes, this. I mean. You know, and I get it from every, like, a lot of the bands that come up here, they're cover bands, you know?
Yeah.
They're like, well, you know, it's not all about us. It's about, you know, it's about the crowds.
Right,
they like to hear
exactly.
that music.
Yeah.
I said, I get it. Okay, I get it. Mm-hmm. I get it. Really get it. But, I mean, what makes your band different than the next band?
Right.
You're playing all the same damn songs, pretty much, you know? A lot of them.
Yeah.
You know? And it's... I'm probably gonna get so much flack after this, but you know, it's like everybody knows me.
I'm just like it when somebody goes out and does something a little bit different, like you know, like hearing Rock Hard do, you know, like Lay It Down. I was like,
oh
that's
yeah. That's
like
what we're talking about,
more, you know.
And they, you know, they do deeper cuts, which is kind of cool, you know.
Yeah.
And I mean, I've had you know bands tell me that like, well, we tried this song and it didn't work, and it's like, what? I mean, you tried that song and it didn't work. Were these people like in a coma or something or what?
They wanted to hear Jesse's Girl.
Jesse's Girl. But that's the whole thing. Because, I mean, you know, when I moved to Austin in 91, it was a pure original scene.
Yeah. Mm.
Everywhere you went, it was an original scene. Mm-hmm. So, but then, you know, after I got out of the game, it was like slowly but surely the cover scene was coming up. Yeah. It was coming on strong.
Well, you know, people got older and they want to go out on the weekends.
It was more of a thing where... This is my opinion of it. It was more of a thing where the club owners are going, okay, you know, people want to listen to live music, but they want to dance, they want to drink, and they want to sing songs that they know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, you know, so if Bobby comes in with his original band singing all his original songs, no one knows mm-hmm. what the fuck's going on.
Yeah.
They're not going to, you know, unless you're playing a bunch of stuff that sounds like Bruno Mars, you could dance around all night, you know.
Yeah.
Which wasn't happening, you know.
Right.
So... And that's what they're starting to do. So that became a big thing where, you know, people could go to these clubs and these big events and, you know, whatever, and hire an 80s band or hire, you know, a
right.
whatever band and play the hits of the day.
Yeah.
Where everybody could get all liquored up and dance around and, you know, get all sweaty and buy some more drinks. And, you know, so it's a win-win, you know.
Yeah.
That's where it's all kind of, you know. So that's where I think the original scene kind of died down because.
Yeah.
Because when I was playing out, it was. We would bring tons of people in because they were all into original music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, but I'll tell you the day that it really burst my bubble of that whole scene was we were playing down at 6th Street and we played. I mean, Vallejo was just getting around. We were at one bar. Vallejo was across the street at another bar. We came in right around the same time. And I mean, Vallejo is still doing it to this day, you know, mm-hmm. killing it still, mm-hmm. you know. But they got, that's just, you know, you got to give it up to those guys. But we would play like 99% originals and we would sprinkle in covers here and there. We, at the end of the set, we would do Metallica or we would do like a Kiss song or we would do like,
that's just fun.
Like a White Zombie song or Marilyn Manson or whatever the case may be. So I remember going into the club just, you know, half an hour before we were going to play. I was going to go upstairs and warm up. And this guy was outside trying to get people to come in the bar, you know. And he goes, yeah, man, this band's really good, man. They play Metallica. And I was like, I was like, dude, we're an original band. Yeah, but you play Metallica, though, right? I said, man, once in a while we play it. But I mean, you know, see, I'm trying to get people in here. I'm like, hello. And then it was like that kind of a thing, you know. And it wasn't about, you know, the original thing of it. It was about, oh, hey, man, you play Seek and Destroy by Metallica, you know, that kind of thing. And I was like, you know, and I saw where it was going. And soon after that, that's where it went, you know.
Yeah.
And now it's to a point now where there's some bars that I'm seeing is where, you know, cover bands were making buku money.
Yeah.
You know, and now it's kind of like drizzling. And now what they're doing is, hey, man, you know, I could easily get a DJ in here and spend the greatest hits of the day and save a ton of money. There's bars doing it, you know, and maybe have, instead of having three or four nights a week of live music, well, let's have one, you know,
put that on kind of mixtape type of thing.
Yeah. Because there's a lot of bands that I go see that I dig their mixtapes in between sets more than I dig them. No, it's the truth.
Yeah.
There's bands I go see. I'm like, man, I like your in between music better than I like you guys. I mean,
put it back on.
No, because there was bands.
Some sound engineers creating some real good break music.
No, but there were some bands that they're not even around anymore, but that would have these phenomenal in between set like CDs or tapes or whatever. I don't know what they're playing. Yeah. I'm like, oh, just kind of going, yeah, man, we're just like forever.
Yeah.
Why don't you play this song? Mm-hmm. And it's like, nah, 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 nah. I'm like, ah, I don't want to hear this shit. Play that song you played during the intermission. I want to hear that song. Then all the girls like, you know, doing the, well, I call it the Caucasian two-step, you know.
You know, as a sound engineer, because I would do private events and I would do all the break music for, you know, bands, or I'd help out with some of that. And, you can't play anything that's in their set. Not supposed to play anything that's in their set. Yeah. That's the whole thing.
Yeah, they should like take their set and throw it away and play the in between music.
Swap them.
There you go.
Yeah, they call it the swap.
I'm sure everybody.
You listen to break music for a lot of bands.
I'm sure all the girls would love to hear Rick Springfield sing his own song.
And now for the intermission, our band will play.
Yeah, but wasn't there like a show where he Rick Springfield came in? It was a bunch of like 80s guys. It was over Cedar Park. It was like,
oh, I saw a thing on TV like that. It had the guy that sang the Ghostbusters song and all that.
Yeah.
See, that's what my friends from Atlanta do. They just do it with like guys from the 70s.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's a lot of those guys that tour now still. It's like the main guy and they have a backing band.
Exactly.
You know?
But they just function as the backing band around all of those people. And then they'll play like the rest of their set where they'll call over.
Like the PBS people.
Yeah. Like, yes. When they do the disco stuff. Yep.
It was
exactly.
It was like the Temptations, Sister Sledge, and Casey and the Sunshine Band, all those bands, you know?
Yeah.
I don't think the Village people were part of that one though, so I don't know. Hey, if you would like if you would donate $50, you could have this memory on DVD for free.
But I will say that I know a lot of original artists here who, you know, that's how they make money.
I just noticed you had a Rock Hard T-shirt. Yeah. Have you seen the new one?
Which one?
The one they have out now.
Well, this is I got.
What does it say on the back?
Yeah, I do bad things when it's rock hard.
Yeah, I saw that. I'm like, I'm not wearing that.
Yeah.
And what I saw was like
this was
like,
a present from Rick Clark.
Yeah, I'm like, I think I'm wearing it. Just put the rock hard on the front, leave that other thing off because I'm like, I wear some crazy shirts, but
I think
I'm like,
well, when I saw them, that this is only on the girly stuff. So, yeah.
What does it say on the back?
I do bad things when it's rock hard.
Oh boy!
It's like I'll have to watch.
That's
where
like
I wear this.
That's like an old Poison shirt. Or I think Poison. Poison used to do crazy shit like that.
Yeah.
Or who was another one? He said there's a couple bands that had really like not say dirty shirts, but stuff you couldn't wear anywhere. I think like Pretty Boy Floyd or one of those bands. They would have kind of just You know, I don't think I can wear that. Oh, the Wasp shirts were the bad ones.
Yes.
Those were bad. The Wasp shirts. Yeah.
I do remember that.
And then I think Metallica had one. It was the first shirt that was like, it said metal up your ass on the back or something like that.
Yeah.
Had a picture of a toilet, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
with,
I remember that.
With
yeah,
a lightning bolt.
Yeah.
Was it a lightning bolt or a sword or something? It's
a
metal
knife
up your ass. That's a nice one.
One of my friends in high school had that one.
Yeah. Yeah. You heard that story, right?
He got his shirt turned. He had to turn it inside out. I do not know this story.
If you listen to the podcast, you've heard the Metallica story about 20 times. I tell
I
it every.
I haven't heard. I'm new to listening to your podcast.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Jennifer.
You probably heard the Metallica story then, right?
Which one?
I'll tell it real quick. Okay. Anybody who's heard the story, just turn it off for like 3 minutes. Because everybody's heard it. Anyways, I grew up in Connecticut, and there was this place called the Agora Ballroom. They had them all over the place.
Yeah.
And one of the shows that was coming through, it was Metallica, Wasp, and Armored Saint.
Mm-hmm.
It was like 1983 going into 84-ish around that area. We were a big Wasp fans, big Blackie Lawless Wasp, the whole thing. That was our thing, you know? Mm-hmm. And, like Wasp is coming. Cool. So what the deal was, they would alternate headlining spots. So one night Metallica would headline, another night Wasp would headline, then it would go back and forth, and Armored Saint would always open. So on our date, Wasp was opening and Metallica was headlining. Right. So we get there, we watch Armored Saint. Wasp comes on, yeah, right? And then after Wasp got off, we left.
Oh,
no.
Because we didn't know who Metallica was.
Oh, no.
And that was when Cliff Burton was with him.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That sucks. Oh.
Now, I could sit here and lie to you all day long saying, hey, man, you know, I went and saw Metallica with Cliff Burton back in when they were playing clubs. Nope.
Oh. Left. Always stay for the whole show, no matter what.
I saw some killer shows at that place, but that's the one. And my buddy that I went with, he moved down here like 10 years after I did. And he was on the podcast, and we were talking about that. He goes, and people to this day are like, oh, no, no.
Oh, man.
Yep.
What was your first show?
My very first show?
Yeah.
Let me see. It's a toss-up. I mean, like arena show or... You're going to laugh. I tell you my first arena show.
What's that?
First arena show. No, wait a minute. Hold on a second. I'm trying to remember because it's such a blur now. I'm not sure if it was Neil Young. I'm going to say it was the Rolling Stones in 81.
Is that Tattoo You?
Yeah.
Nice.
So, you want to know the funny thing about it was, guess how much tickets were. I still have the ticket for it.
It's got to be like less than $10.
No, it wasn't. It was more, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well,
$15.50.
Man.
Yeah, my sister took me. Yeah, so. But, yeah, after that, when I started going to shows myself, it was like, you know, Kiss and Motley Crue and all that stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think after that, but the next show after that was like Neil Young did an acoustic tour.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and that was my next one. I was like 13, 14. I mean, you know, when I saw the Stones, I was like 13.
Yeah.
In 81. I was born in 68, so. But that whole, I mean, we saw, and that little club, we saw everybody. Everybody came through there that, you know, actually got to big places, you know.
Yeah.
And they're all band fans now. The band fans. Except for Motley Crue. Motley Crue did pretty good. So I think Rat is traveling in a van now. I think.
Oh, man.
Well, yeah. Well, yeah, because it's.
Which Rat?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
There are lots of vans.
The Bobby Blotzer Rat is done. He's done. So, yeah.
Because Stephen Piercy has kind of a reboot. But.
Well, yeah. Well, it's three of the five guys.
Yeah.
So I'd go see that. I guess I would.
Yeah, I would.
I remember seeing them down. They played on 6th Street.
Yeah.
And it was, I think, man, who, I'm going to say John Corabi was playing guitar from the Scream. Of course, he sang Motley Crue.
Yeah.
But I think it was the original guys except for John Corabi. And they played this dingy hole on 6th Street. And I think Warrant maybe opened up. It was.
On 6th Street?
Yeah. Hmm. It was this club that was, It was only there for a little bit. And it was like towards like the highway kind of, you know, towards 35
I know where you're talking about because they turned it into a daiquiri bar in the 90s.
Yeah, but it was there only there for a little while. Yeah. I saw a couple, couple, two, three shows there. And that was, I think Warrant was one.
And for a few years, like maybe 5-6 years ago, they were using it as like a venue for Chevy during South By.
I don't remember what it was called, though.
The only time I ever knew it actually had a name, it was like, you know, some daiquiri bar.
Do you remember? You remember Foxy's Foxy's Firehouse?
No, that was that was before my time.
Woo! There's a this is the best story ever. Well, one of the best stories ever. If when you go down on 6th Street, like towards the highway, you have like these the entrances. You have to kind of go down steps to get into them, kind of a thing.
Mm. Yeah.
Well, someone opened a topless bar called Foxy's Firehouse at one of those clubs, and you'd walk in, and the ceiling was so low, you have to go like this. And the girls were dancing when they and they had like a table with a pole, and the girls would the ceilings were so low. So they were like, you know, if you weren't born a hunchback, you were real, really kind of, you know, or a dwarf or something, you know what I mean? So they couldn't spin. If they spun, they kind of had to, like, you know, do like a split and then spin because, I mean, you're like, oh. Shit was fun. That place lasted about, like a month or two. I think I went there once. I mean, I was like 20, 25 years old.
That's because everyone could tell when they got home. Their wives could tell. Hey, you went to that bar.
Foxy's Firehouse. I should Google that stuff. Foxy's Firehouse. And the funny thing, it only had like 3 or 4 tables in it. It looked like somebody's closet. The room couldn't have been maybe twice as big as this. That's how big it was. God. Yeah, it was horrible. Well, I mean, you know, back at that time, I mean, you know, it was just, they had an ordinance on topless bars. They could only have so many.
Oh, okay.
It wasn't like Dallas or Houston. They have them all over the place. Yeah. I think there was like, you could have 6 and that was it. And so when one would close up, another one would pop right up. So I don't know how they got, who had the idea or how it came to fruition, how this Foxy's Firehouse.
On 6th Street.
On 6th Street, of all places.
Of all places, yeah.
Yeah, but you'd walk in, you'd have to be kind of like, it's sort of like walk in, they don't have basements here, but up north they have basements. Mm-hmm. You kind of walk down, you kind of have to, you know.
Yes.
It was like that. But the ceilings, I think the ceilings were like, maybe 6.5 feet. No, it was taller than that. Cause, I mean, you could walk, but the girls had to, like, you know, if you're over 5'2", you know, you had the problem. I gotta Google that. Hold on. I think it lasted for like it couldn't have been more than 3 months that joint was there. But you know, but that's how 6th is though. It's like, you know, it's just not, there's not many stuff. The only thing that I recognize from then. From then, it's like, you know, Aaron's Rock and Roll and Esther's Follies. The rest of it has changed.
Yeah.
And there's nothing left.
Mm-hmm. So, Jennifer, what was your first arena show?
The Mamas and the Papas.
Well, I will say in my defense, it was at Red Rocks.
Fancy.
Because I grew up as a kid in Colorado Springs.
Fancy.
But my first show was in 86. And it was the 20th anniversary tour of the Monkees.
Oh, man, I wish I could have seen
that. The Monkees.
with Gary Puckett and the Union Gap and Herman's Hermits.
Oh, wow.
That's a PBS show right there. That
opening
was on there, Herman
them.
And Hermits.
Oh, my God, yeah.
Monkees.
And it was
wow.
They did that reunion tour, like when, you know, like all of the show blew up on MTV again, where they've been rerunning it, and then they, you know, recorded a new album. And you know, my sister and I were huge Monkees fans growing up as kids. That was like one of my mom's favorite.
We
bands.
Had some. My sister had some Monkees albums.
Oh, I have every single one of them, and I've.
How many did they have? Like 5.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
About 5 or 6 of them.
Yeah.
Now, did they play on all those or?
Not the first 2. But others besides that, yeah.
Did they sing on them at least?
Yeah.
I don't know much, you know, I know about the band sort of, but.
Yeah, well, when they started out, you know.
It's for a TV
they
show.
Yeah. Like basically they put out an open audition and wanted to have kind of a mix of, you know, actors and musicians. So two of them were actually musicians. And, you know, the guy who ended up getting stuck with the bass on the show was probably the best guitarist. And he, like, you know, hung out with, like, the Mamas and the Papas and a whole bunch of other people in New York and then in San Francisco. And...
Well, that was
played like you know 10 different instruments.
So when did they it was like 66 they came out, was it? Uh-huh. Or was it later than that?
Yeah, 66.
Around that time, yeah.
Yeah.
She's crazy. Even got a Monkees Maraca.
Oh, I got that from the last show. So I've seen I have seen them.
You put that in storage. You can make some money off of that.
I've seen them I think like 4 or 5 times now.
Really? Are they still I think a couple of them are dead though, right?
Well, one of them is.
Which one?
Davey.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He passed away a couple of years ago. But
Davey's son now in there.
Yeah. No.
Davey Jr.
No. I mean, these dudes are like my dad's age. It's kind of crazy. You know, but
a lot of those guys are.
Yeah.
Although that's the funny thing about it is, you know, you look at like all the bands that I grew up with are all like, you know, they should be retiring. They just should be. You know what I mean? And a lot of them, for some weird reason, this year is the year that a lot of them are like Deep Purple's doing a final farewell tour. Aerosmith is doing their final farewell tour.
Mm-hmm. That's hard to believe.
I wish. Yeah. No, seriously. Yeah, they're doing one more track. Yeah, they're probably doing an album. That's gonna be it. Because those guys, I mean, you know, they're each worth about $100 million a piece at least.
Yes.
You know, and it's like, you know what? I mean, you proved your point. You've been around the world 1,000 times. Mm. You know, and I mean, might as well like live the rest of your life and enjoy it. You know, it's just. You don't need to be torn like that when you're 70 years old.
Touring, no. But, you know, I just go back to, like, playing with the hell is... what do they call that? The old cella? The trip? The one that's not in the desert where it's basically a bunch of...
Oh, yeah. They just had that one with the Who and Paul McCartney.
Yeah,
and
they're calling it old cella.
Is it old cella?
I think it's actually called Desert Trip. But it's like it's super expensive.
Oh yeah, know? Well look who's on it.
Goes on it. Yeah, it's basically
Paul McCartney. They had the Who. They had who else was on it? Wasn't it like the Eagles or something on it too? There was some big name. I mean, huge names.
Yeah, it was huge.
The Stones
names.
Played one night.
Yeah, yeah.
Crazy money.
Yeah. So
and you think you're gonna
get to doing that?
You know, and that's the thing. It's like, you know. Like a band like The Who, I can't even believe they're even still around doing anything. I mean, you know, that half of that band is done. I mean, they've been done for 20 years. Or actually, one of them has been dead for like 30, 40 years, actually.
Yes.
You know, Keith Moon died, what, 78? 78?
Like I don't remember.
Yeah, I think that's right.
Yeah. That's one of my favorite bands of all time. I love The Who, you know. Never got to see them, but I mean, you know, the original Who. Mm-hmm. But what are you going to do?
Yeah. And so then the first show I went to on my own without parents was Warrant in Oklahoma City and with Firehouse opening up for them.
Wow. Oh my God. Damn, I wouldn't admit that. No, I'm just kidding.
That was
I'm trying to remember the first show I actually went to myself.
91, I think.
Man, I had to be like it had to be Kiss or something. Had probably a Kiss show or something.
My first one on my own was Danzig and Marilyn Manson, but it was before all the crazy outfits. Marilyn Manson was an opening act, and it was the Coliseum here in Austin, over by Auditorium Shores. And I remember Glenn fell off the stage. I was like,
I got a great Manson story.
Oh,
yeah. Oh! This is a great one. I wasn't there when it happened. I was there the day after. We played this club. It's like, man, 95, 96-ish. And this place up in Kansas. I'm trying to think where it was. Anyways, it was originally like an insane asylum back in the 40s or 50s or something, right?
Yeah.
So they bought it and turned it into this rock club. And they used to have, like, Rodax and stuff. Anyways, Manson was just coming up at that time. And that's when he was, like, you know, cutting himself and just doing all sorts of crazy shit. And so, anyways, he played there, like, on a Friday. We were there on a Saturday. It was Wichita, Kansas. I think it was called Rock Island, from what I remember. But anyways, we get there on a Saturday, like, you know, to load in, like, around noon or 1 o'clock, whatever it was. And the owner comes over and he goes, man, goes, please don't tell me, you know, you're going to do the shit that Manson did up here last night or was trying to do. I'm like, what are you talking about, this man? He goes, if you guys pull that shit, he goes, I'll have the cops up here so fast. So basically what he wanted to do, this is so bad. I don't know what I'm telling you this story for. I don't know if he would have done it, but, you know, back then he did a lot of crazy mm-hmm. shit. Mm-hmm. He wanted to take a turkey baster and up his butt on stage. He's wanted, you know what I mean? So that's what he wanted to do on stage. So, you know, this guy that owned the club was like this, you know, Oklahoman.
Yeah.
Oklahoma, wow. Guy from Oklahoma, you know, and he was this, I remember he was from Oklahoma, moved to Kansas. And, you know, he's like, you ain't doing that shit in my club, whatever, whatever, you know. Yeah. So I guess that didn't happen. But at one point in the show, he stands in the front and he's like, back then he had real long hair and he used to wear like these high, like the platform boots.
Yeah.
And he'd have these little panties on or whatever, you know. He's like, he was like this. He's like, I want everybody to spit on me.
Oh, my God.
So everybody just was hawking loogies on him. And so he was just, and so the guy goes, it was, man, they got done. It looked like he was melting.
Oh, man.
Yeah. And then, you know, he was cutting himself. And I mean, just to get a rise out of the crowd. And that club was not that big. It couldn't have been, you know, more than, shit, I don't know, maybe 300 people. It was, you know, but back then he really wasn't anything back then. But it was that whole, the night before was a thing. And then we were finding stuff in the dressing room that was like, you know, slices of bologna up on the window and stuff. Just kind of crazy shit, you know.
Making headlines.
Yeah, but back then he would just do some outlandish shit, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, I remember, you know, kind of looking out the window. Why is there a slice of bologna on the window?
You probably don't want to know.
Probably just deli tray up on the window. Yeah. Yeah, that was a pretty cool club, though. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's my Manson story. So. But I did get to see him later on, and it was so way the other direction when I saw him. He was like, you know, in his 40s. I mean, he's mm-hmm. I think he's probably a little bit older than I am, I would think. Maybe early 50s he is now, maybe.
He's kind of mellowing out a little.
Well, I would think so. I mean, like, you know. He's done with turkey basters, I guess. I don't know. I was like, nah, don't worry. We're not going to stick turkey basters up our butts or anything. We're good. I'm good. These guys, I don't know about these guys. These guys might. Maybe they brought their own turkey basters. That's crazy. Shit people like. I don't know. That's funny. Well, this is what we're going to do. Poor Marty didn't say anything all night over.
Marty.
You got anybody you want to say hello to at least? Anything? Anybody? It's like, no.
I'll tell you about my first concert.
Yeah, let's hear it. Yeah, there we go. I'm sorry. We didn't mean to overlook you. We're just chatterboxes. That's all we have.
The first one that I went to on my own was Boston.
Oh, that's a good one.
Nice, yeah.
But the first one that my parents took me to was John Denver.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Now you know why I was so.
I love it.
Like, you got Denver. To go to the Monkees for your
I
first
know.
One. Yeah, I know. Yeah, you know, and the thing about it is for Boston, I would love to hear who opened up. Yeah. Probably was like Ted Nugent or Journey
I don't even remember.
Yeah, because back
were.
Then, I mean, that's I think Nugent was a big I remember. Yeah, when Boston came out, I think Journey was a big opener for them. I think Nugent was. I can't remember who else. I had to look it up. But I remember seeing a bill with those bands on it.
Did you see that they played down at the Long Center?
Who?
Out on the lawn, Boston.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you know who was playing?
That was in the fall.
Do you know who was playing in Boston forever?
Who?
Remember remember that band Striper?
Yeah.
The singer. The singer. Aww. Yeah, Michael Sweet was singing in Boston for a long time.
Wow.
Yeah. Killing it. Killing it.
Sure.
He's a great singer.
Yeah.
Killing it.
I thought Striper was kind of ridiculous, but he was a great singer.
They're a good band. You know, too much into the Jesus thing, but I mean, you know.
I don't know about the Striper.
I remember going to see them at the same club that I sort of saw Metallica at. No, I didn't see Metallica. But I did get to see Metallica right after that, though, at an arena. Opening for Ozzy.
Oh, I bet that was good.
They're great live.
Who, Metallica?
Yeah.
I might go down to San Antonio and go check them out this time. I'm not thinking about it, but it's like, you know, I just don't feel like spending like those that money. It's just like, you know.
Yeah. Sarah and I got tickets to go see U2 on the Joshua Tree tour where they're going to play the whole album. And
where are they playing?
They're coming through Houston. I don't know where.
I saw them when they opened up the Cowboy Stadium. They were one of the first bands. I think they were the first band to play there. Mm-hmm. And that's the big debacle was. They have that big jumbotron there or whatever.
Yeah, and they
had to spend $2 million just to raise that thing up. I don't know why it cost $2 million to raise it, but no, they had to raise it because their stage set wouldn't fit in there. It's so big.
Oh, gotcha.
And it was crazy. It was good, though. But I remember, it was funny thing about it, I remember seeing U2, this is how far back I go with U2, is I remember seeing them at a college.
Yeah.
Yale University, like in 1980. When did, all right, so Boy came out in what, 81?
Mm-hmm.
So it was right after Boy.
Is that War?
No. Boy, there was Boy, then October, and then War. It was between Boy and in October.
Okay.
And they played like a college. It was like, I don't know, maybe 500 people. And then it was Bono's birthday. They brought him out a cake and everything. But they played all the stuff from October. They played all the stuff from Boy. And they played a couple songs from October, and that was their set. That was it. And after that, they went boom.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah, pretty much.
So you caught that one.
Yeah.
You caught that one.
But I actually went with a friend of mine who was a major Monster U2 fan. And he was following them before Boy came out. He saw them, like on bootleg cassette tapes and shit. You know what I mean? That's how far he goes back with them.
Because this is pre-YouTube. You had to really work to follow.
I think about that all the time. It's like, how the hell did we find out about bands back then? It was just because, I mean, all the bands that I listened to, they never got any radio play, you know? Mm-hmm. You just found it was word of mouth, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's why kids are so oversaturated with stuff nowadays, because they just got so much, you know?
Mm-hmm.
What are you going to do? I don't know.
All
right, let's burn these dates out one more time because, man, we're like 2.5 hours in already.
I know.
you believe that? I'm not kicking you out. I'm just saying.
Somebody else want to do the honors this time?
Go ahead, Cheryl.
Give it to Marty. Let's hear Marty. Yeah. Marty can talk.
Let's hear that beautiful voice.
So, Marty, where are we playing,
Marty?
Where are we playing? Okay, we are playing Texas Mist on Saturday, March 25th. The doors are going to open between 7 and 8. Small Town Girls are going on at 10, Fire Women at 11, and we are followed by
War Pigs
with Kimmer.
So much better than your presentation. Much better. What's the cover? Anyone know what the cover is?
Oh, I don't know.
I'm gonna assume the cover is somewhere between 5 and 10.
10? What?
I'm just kidding.
Because baby, we're worth it, okay?
So you got how many bands? Four bands?
Three bands.
Three bands.
It was supposed to be four, and... yeah, Kitty couldn't play.
Oh.
Yeah. Hopefully again soon.
Yeah.
I know she was working on some lineup changes.
What? Already?
Well.
I'm just kidding. Yeah. I love Kitty to death. She's so much fun.
And then, I don't know about y'all, but the night before, I'm going over to the Highball to see Pretties for You, a mostly female Alice Cooper tribute,
really except for Ozzy.
It was really funny. We had a conversation over at Wagner's backyard.
Yeah,
and we were talking about that album, that Alice Cooper album.
Yeah,
I'm like, that thing sucked. I go into these little modes where I buy every album from a certain artist, and I just kind of do like a whole. Say discography thing or whatever, but it's like I really kind of dive deep. So one of the artists was going to be Alice Cooper, right? So I'm going to start at the beginning. That's their first album or his first album. I think Alice Cooper was an actual band back then. Was he even called Alice Cooper back then? I think the band was called Alice Cooper. I don't think he was Alice Cooper.
I don't think he'd taken on quite the persona.
Yeah. So anyways, it was put out on Frank Zappa's label. And it's the weirdest album, one of the weirdest albums you'll ever listen to in your life. It's just really kind of avant-garde-ish, strange.
That's what happens when you have Frank Zappa producing an album.
So I had to spend, I mean, it was like out of print, and I actually found some place that had it. I don't know, I can't remember if I ordered it somewhere. think I actually found it somewhere. Right. Anyways, so I bring the thing home. Like, oh, I'm going to listen to this. I put on my going, what the fuck? What is this? You know? So, yes, yeah. So we were over talking, you know. Yeah, that's it. That's it. That's actually not the album cover.
No.
That's the band.
That's the band.
Well, that's pretty cool.
You should have them up here. They're a lot of fun.
They look kind of scary. Is that are they all girls or just?
Like I said, all girls, one dude.
Yeah, I see the. I think that's a dude. Yeah, I kind of. Yeah, it looks like a dude. Yeah.
Uh huh. Yeah. So.
Is that what they wear on stage?
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah. That's nice. And they've got quite the stage setup. Actually, they inspired us.
They blow up shit or what?
No. They
I missed that.
I wish.
Ever since Great White just ruined it for everybody.
I know.
That's terrible.
That's
awful.
That's terrible.
That is terrible.
God.
I actually, you know the buddy I told you about for the Metallica show that we went as kids?
Yeah.
His cousin was at that show. And it was Rhode Island, right?
Yeah.
He was at that show.
Oh, man.
He got out, though. Oh. Yeah, it was a bad mess.
That is terrible. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, they have, it's an Alice Cooper tribute. So they bring up, you know, skeletons and they've got like candelabras. On top of the amps and stuff. It's awesome. And then somebody in the band, I think, is a stylist because there's a bunch of wig heads set up with Alice's makeup. And
That's cool, though. At least it's a show, you know?
I know. Right. So, the first time I saw them, I turned to Sarah and I was like, we need to do some stuff.
What does the cult do?
I'm about to tell you.
So, can you tell me?
Yes.
I don't want to spoil the show.
So... We were.
You don't pull out whips or nothing, do you?
No. I know. We were at some festival and drinking, and I was like, "We need to have shit on stage." And she's like,
"The turkey basters or nothing."
She's like, "What do you want on stage, Jennifer?" I'm like, "Huge fucking dream catchers."
That's right. You did tell me about this. That's right.
So, actually, I have a friend who is a wood and metal artist, who is very kind enough, Chris Levac, who is very kind enough to let us showcase one of his works, and it is going to sit up above Cheryl and the drum riser, and it's pretty cool.
Is that awesome?
Is that a horse head? What is that?
It's actually prehistoric wood.
In the shape of a horse head.
And basically, yeah.
It's not a horse head.
Well,
I mean,
no,
is that?
Like,
it's like a bull,
like a longhorn.
Right?
Yeah, exactly. And then, yeah, it's all a sculpture. It's amazing. So that's going up behind
Cheryl. It's like petrified wood, you said?
Yeah, petrified wood.
How do they, how do they carve petrified wood? Because it's pretty hard, right?
Well, yeah. a lot of
is
it
a
is.
Stupid question?
No, it's not.
Stupid question?
No, because it's like.
It's sort of like, getting a big diamond and trying to, like, chisel out a. Just a lot of horse head out of a big diamond. So how did I mean?
It's
like rock, right?
Yeah, it's like rock. Well, that one's not as much like that. It's because this is like plant.
Dumb question.
Because this is like plant material. And then like that's what it looks like, you know, from the side, so you can see like the depth of it. But yeah,
that's cool.
He was just kind of inspired by what he found, and then did some shaping. But
you won't find that in Jersey, I'll tell you right now.
So he's letting us borrow that, and then we have.
That's the cool thing about Austin, though.
We hopefully have a place letting us borrow some really pretty long dream catchers, and
Are those also petrified too? Or
No.
Non-petrified.
So I was like, we're gonna make it a show. We're gonna have.
You guys would be driving home, going, "This guy's out of his mind." What the hell? They ain't coming. Don't ever have me come up here again. That was ridiculous. Why am I wasting my time with this petrified and horse heads?
Yeah, and have like cow skull on stage, and I want to find some pelts. Throw those over the monitor speakers.
Do you ever find that market with the snake heads and pelts?
No.
Snake heads and pelts.
Yeah, somebody snapped me a picture on Facebook and said that there was somebody selling like snake heads and pelts by the side of the road, like on 620 or whatever. And like I immediately responded, I'm like, where? And two other people were like, we knew you would be the first person to respond.
You're going on a dripping
this.
Springs for all sorts of crazy shit down there.
I saw that come through and I'm like, I gotta tell Jennifer, and she was already all over that. And I think it was supposed to be like a ha ha thing, but she was.
I know.
All over
well,
because yeah.
like you know, I mean, that's half the fun of this. Like mm-hmm. I got into a lot of this because I like to perform, and so like before when we've we did a Kiss tribute. I have some great pictures from that. And it really does take 2 hours, 2 to 3 hours to do that Paul Stanley makeup. I will tell you that.
You know what's really funny about the Paul Stanley makeup, though? Mm-hmm. It kills me. 99% of the people do it. They do the makeup in the mirror, right? Mm-hmm. So the star's on this side, not this side.
Right.
They
right.
always do it. I'm like, you know. No. Get the stars. No, it's in the right side. No. When no. you look in the mirror, it's on the right side. But when you're out in public, it's on the wrong side. Trust me, I know this.
It
kind of
so
cracks
true.
Me up.
So true.
But it's like, it just looks weird. But so yeah. used to seeing it the other way.
When we did Kiss, we all totally dressed up. When we did Motley Crue. Oh, yeah. Here's.
It's funny. If you read Paul Stanley's. If you read Paul Stanley's autobiography. Good Lord. Who's that in the middle?
That's me.
That's you?
Yeah, that's me dressed as Vince, you know.
Who's Tommy Lee? Oh, that guy right there? I can't tell.
It's all women.
at that
that's
show.
All chicks, really?
Yeah.
Damn. Okay. Wow. I thought that was Greg Allman in the back. It looked like Greg Allman, right?
Wait a minute. Oh, no, that's Heather Webb.
That's what I thought it was, though. Look at it. It's like Greg Allman.
Oh, my God.
Allman Brothers Band.
I got to tell Heather. Great
hi, Heather.
Hi, Heather. She's going to call him stabbing when she meets me.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm the one he told. Looks like Greg Allman.
You know what's funny? I have that was around when I just met Jennifer.
There you go.
That mm-hmm. was around when I had just met Jennifer when they did the Motley Crue. I had met her a few nights before, and I'm at that show in the audience, and I'm going to someone. She did a bunch of bands, different outfits, and I'm going, "Where's Jennifer? Where's Jennifer?" And it took me a minute to realize that was her.
That's funny.
It's fun.
Oh yeah, totally. There's Greg Allman again, right in the back. Greg Allman with Levi's shorts on. That's funny. Hey, I love the Allman Brothers Band. They're a great band. They were, you know. No, but if you read Paul Stanley's autobiography,
yeah,
the very beginning of it, I got the audio book. I don't like to read.
Yeah, we were talking about this.
I like to read.
I loved that book. My friend Johnny Gotti had recommended it to me, and I, you know, it's one of the few. I don't like to go back and read books often.
Yeah.
It's one that I like went right back through.
But if you listen to it or read it or whatever, he goes through on how he applies the makeup down to the powder and what kind of stuff he uses and how he applies it and how he does it.
Yeah,
and it sounds like damn, that's a lot of work.
It is because you know, like it. The outline and then doing all of that and then trying to set it all, because if you don't set it and you go anywhere near your face, you're screwed.
It's like I don't know,
but it was fun. So yeah, like have the fun of this is like getting to dress up.
Course,
I mean you know, like you know, it's funny.
It's like my superhero fetish, you know? Once a year.
Exactly. Right.
You get it.
Oh man, those pictures are horrible. Man,
I think we did a gig where we played the Austin Marathon out on the street, you know, like what was that, a month or so ago?
In January. Yeah.
8:30 in the morning. And so they were like, my God, I came out there, you know, full costume, hat.
It's funny because you can actually buy like those Kiss costumes now, the real ones. You can go,
and
they're
totally.
Like oogles amount of money.
Yeah.
I'd love to have one, but it's like, we're going to wear it. You know, I can't go to HEB in it or another. Walk around.
Run into Matthew McConaughey's mom. Hey. Yeah. Hey. What's up, mama?
She's a trip. Anyways, all right. I think we're going to sign off now so we can get everybody home. And y'all could like, you know, complain to each other on the way home. Wow, why the hell do we do this tonight? It's ridiculous.
Thanks for having us.
Oh, no, anytime. It's a blast. We had like the weird thing about it was she'll tell you all about it. I was like kind of working these two episodes and kind of bouncing back and forth. And it's always a scheduling thing with this all the time. I try to do my Mondays and Wednesdays. Mm-hmm. Because everybody I knows in a band, you know, and everybody
so
wants
playing Friday, Saturday,
Friday,
night.
Saturday nights or whatever, you know? So it's like a thing where, you know, and sometimes it's a last minute thing, you know, I can't make it tonight. You know, can we do it Wednesday? And so anyways, I wanted to get you girls up here and, you know, I'm like, well, man, next week I could kind of maybe do it, but I'm not sure about this one and that one. And we're just juggling it around. And finally today came up. So I was like, boom.
Well, I'm glad.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And I'm glad I ran into you at LC Rocks.
Yeah.
That was hilarious.
I think she was stalking us, though.
No.
She walks up to me.
No.
Hey. I'm like, no, oh, hey, oh.
No, I get this. I get this, you know.
Stalker.
Bobby Sharon is nearby.
Oh, I was like, oh.
Ken Liao okay. is nearby.
You gotta fight Crystal,
Matt
though.
Matt Bray is nearby. I'm like, okay. But no, like I actually that day I found out I got a new job and I start my new job on Monday.
Awesome.
So, yeah.
Can you say where you're working?
I work for an Italian luxury company currently and I'm going to another Italian luxury company.
Oh.
So, yeah.
What does that entail, an Italian luxury company? sounds like an escort service.
Sales management.
Sales management.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hmm. Italian.
Uh-huh.
So what do they do? I mean, can I ask what they do, or is this off limits?
No. I mean, the first one
sounds a little sketchy to me.
No.
is it legal?
Yeah.
In all 50 states?
No, they're I'm down in San Marcos.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So
an Italian luxury service in San Marcos. Yeah. Okay. I get it.
So I was out that night because nobody else could go out, and I was like, screw it. I keep getting invited to go to LC Rock shows, and I haven't been to one in a long time. So I just went out and I saw about half a dozen people that I know in the audience. So I think I also ran into John Montez, who I've known.
John Montez. Yes, he was up there.
I've known John for 6-7 years because the sound company that I worked for, we used to do all of Encore Sound.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah. So I have been to lots of Encore shows and their lighting. I've been to lots of Encore shows over the last.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, he was there with, I guess, their original singer.
That's right.
What's her name?
I don't remember. I know I can introduce. Sorry, John.
I know.
But she
like lives like in like, man, it's like Alabama or something. She drove all the way here from.
Like they were going to do some they were doing some more casino dates and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it was like the original lineup of Encore, or like part of it or something, because they were gonna do a show up at the Oasis, and it got canceled because of weather.
Oh yeah.
So,
yeah, that band spawned a whole bunch of other cover bands too.
Oh God, man. They all spawned them.
Like,
seriously, if I got like I'm gonna probably do one of these podcasts. I'm gonna put a white piece of paper.
Yeah.
And start with this band,
uh-huh.
And dribble it down. Okay, this guy plays over here.
Yeah,
and
there's a bunch of the folks, or some of the folks that are in Trick Shot used to be in Encore at one point or another.
Oh, yeah. It's
and then
craziness.
There's Scottish Thunder.
That's right.
Yeah.
I actually went and saw those guys. The same night I went and saw Jesse's band over on Rock Tavern, the Tool band,
yeah.
Naked and Fearless. They were playing up the street over at Quinn's. So we stopped them for a couple minutes, and then we just bounced around, and but yeah, they're interesting. No, they're interesting people. I mean, it's kind of fun. No, they were up here, did an episode with me, and they're just love Star Wars. They love Star Wars. But they're great people though. This which is, I don't know, it's crazy. They just love Star Wars. That's all I can tell you. Listen to the podcast, you're like.
Did you learn a lot that you didn't know about Star Wars?
But it's like they're deep into Star Wars. I mean, deep. I've seen Star Wars a gazillion times, but they knew more stuff than I've ever knew existed. They're like in a, I had a buddy, at work, to make a very long story short. I guess they have a new series of Star Wars. It's called Rogue One or something something.
Yeah, have you not seen the movie?
Not, I haven't seen Rogue One.
Okay, so basically,
I know what the premise behind it is now.
They take like a plot device from the original movie,
but it's not
like two sentences, and they turn it into a movie.
Right. Mm-hmm. So I got this buddy at work. I got a buddy at work. He's a Star Wars freak too, and
yeah.
He goes, "I'm going to go see the new Star Wars this weekend." I'm like, "That's not the real Star Wars. What are you talking about? That's the real Star Wars." I said, "No, it's not. That's not the real Star Wars. The Star Wars are first three, the second three,
mm-hmm.
Now they're doing the
last
third three or whatever.
Yeah.
I don't know
what
they're going to pull out. But, and so I had an argument with this guy at work about what real Star Wars was and what wasn't real Star Wars. So I told them that, and they got really offended that I thought that wasn't the real Star Wars.
I don't know.
Yes, it is. I'm like, no, it's not.
Well, I mean, it's part of the canon because literally, I did think that was really interesting. Yeah. They take basically what is a convenient plot device, you know, in the 70s, as far as like, oh, we found this and here it is. And they turn it into, you know, like basically a saga about the evils and how war is hell. Mm-hmm. You know, I honestly thought it was probably outside of Empire. It was probably my favorite movie.
Wow.
It was pretty good.
Really?
It's pretty good in 3D, too. Tell you.
Outside. Yeah.
So anyways,
outside of Empire. Yeah.
So anyways, the idea now is what we're going to do since we have the 4K now. I'm going to actually hang that up there over here. Mm-hmm. We're going to Scottish Thunder and myself. We're going to have a Star Wars viewing podcast where we're gonna watch Star Wars and have a podcast in the middle of it, just watching Star Wars like this.
Nice.
That was my idea though. So I thought it would be a cool idea. It'd be something different, you know?
Yeah. Have a little commentary going on.
So I can't remember which one of the
your
the
own version of Mystery Science Theater.
Sort of kinda like that. Not as dumb, but you know. Maybe more dumb actually. And they were talking about, well, we could bring lightsabers up there. I'm like, I don't know about all that. You know, lightsabers, are we going to start swinging them around in the studio? I mean,
dudes.
Not anyways. Next to the TV.
Yeah.
Dudes and their lightsabers.
Dudes.
4K is cool, though.
Yeah,
it's pretty badass.
I just
badass.
Got into that. It's pretty cool.
Hell yeah.
And Amazon Prime has some 4K programs.
Well, I mean, because Netflix does, too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was like,
yeah.
I'm a tech. I love all junk when it works. Anyways. All right. Well, I was going to say Scottish Thunder. I don't know why. 5 Women. It'll be the best cult tribute we've ever seen in your whole life. Ever. Ever. The best in the whole world. I'm not even making fun of it. I'm just saying.
We are the world's, to my knowledge, we are the world's first all-female tribute to cult.
I would probably think so, yeah.
Yeah. Well, no, I've done extensive research. We are.
Really?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. I'll take your word for it then. I'm not going to argue with you. I'm not going to get my head bit off again about the Star Wars. So. I kind of just leave that one alone now. So, one more time.
Okay.
And then we're going to end it.
Saturday night, Texas Miss, Saturday, March 25th. Doors at 7. Small Town Girls Journey Tribute at 10, Fire Women at 11, War Pigs at midnight. And then Sunday afternoon, Independence Brewery on Todd Lane, Nicole Wagner at about 2 or 3 o'clock, and we'll be going on between 3 and 4.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Bring all your money. You guys got t-shirts and stuff?
No,
it's in the works.
We have artwork.
Just don't put that saying on yours in the back. Don't put that on there.
We have artwork being worked on right now. We have a logo coming up.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Yep.
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, some tattoo guy did that for me. So.
Yeah,
that's nice.
Yeah, that's a good. I mean, it's one.
Crazy looking, huh?
It looks just like you.
I know, huh? So handsome.
Yeah. All.
I have a good friend who's working on the artwork for us.
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm gonna definitely have you lovely ladies back again.
Aww,
and next time I'm gonna have you talk more. Okay. All right. I think that's gonna be it. What do you think? You guys gonna do some quick shout outs for anybody? Anybody? No?
I think, are we okay?
You're all burnt out, you're like, I'm fucking get me out. It's fucking 3 hours. Get me out of here. It's 3 hours, get me out of here. All right, we're out. Everybody go see the Fire Women.
Yes, at Fire Women Cult.
.com.
Facebook, Instagram.
Facebook. Yep. Hey, and
send us a message.
Just let everybody know, please go to Facebook to the Cobra Cast podcast with Bobby Sharon, because I'm right near 500 likes. I need some more likes. I just want to hit that 500. I just want to hit 500. That's all I want.
What are you going to do when you hit 500?
I don't know. I'm a big party.
Ooh.
All right. There you go.
If you like it, maybe you'll get invited to the party. You never know.
It's kind of funny. I've had like, man, already, I mean, and this is episode number 40.
Wow.
Yeah, it's how time flies. It's really weird. Had a lot of people up here. A lot of unsavory people, but, you know, how people. All right. We're out. Everybody take care. And I think we're doing an Invicta fight cast this weekend. So that's the all-female MMA.
Oh, my God.
Yes, yeah, so it's like a little branch off the UFC, and it's women, but it's all women fighting.
Cool.
So we're going to have the 4K up here, and we'll be betting some big money. So that's what we do, though. So that's going to be Saturday night. All right, everybody, take care, and talk to you soon. See you on Saturday night sometime. Later. Bye.